I call on the Minister of Financial Services to read the prayer.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Let us pray. Almighty God, from whom all wisdom and power are derived, we beseech thee so to direct and prosper the deliberations of the Legislative Assembly now assembled, that all things may be ordered upon the best and surest foundations for the glory of thy name, and for the safety, honor, and welfare of the people of these islands. Bless our Sovereign Lady, Queen Elizabeth II, Philip, Duke of Edinburgh, Charles, Prince of Wales, and all the royal family. Give grace to all who exercise authority in our Commonwealth, that peace and happiness, truth and justice, religion and piety may be established among us. Especially, we pray for the Governor of our islands, the Premier, the Speaker of the Legislative Assembly, the Leader of the Opposition, Ministers of the Cabinet, ex-officio members, and members of the Legislative Assembly, that we may be enabled faithfully to perform the responsible duties of our high office. All this we ask for in thy great name's sake. Let us say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord make his face shine upon us and be gracious unto us. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon us and give us peace, now and always. Amen.
Please be seated.
Administration of oaths or affirmations?
None.
Reading by the Honorable Speaker of messages and announcements.
I have apologies from Madam Speaker.
Presentation of petitions?
None.
Presentation of papers and of reports. Report of the Standing Finance Committee on the appropriation July 2016 to December 2017, Bill 2016. To be laid on the table by the Honorable Minister of Finance and Economic Development, Chairman of the Standing Finance Committee.
I call on the Honorable Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I beg to lay on the table of this Honorable House the report of the Standing Finance Committee on the appropriation July 2016 to 31st December 2017 bill. 2016.
So ordered. Does the Honorable Minister wish to speak there at all?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, in accordance with Standing Order 64, subsection 7, the Standing Finance Committee agreed that I submit to this Honorable House the report of the Committee on the Appropriation Bill for Government's 2016-17 fiscal period. The Committee had its first meeting on the 14th of June and met for 7 days subsequent to that, with the last meeting being this morning to approve the report, which I just tabled, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the Committee also considered the schedule to the bill and approved the various appropriations requested thereon without amendment to either of those appropriations. And the committee also agreed to disperse up to $7,995,000 from the Environmental Protection Fund with respect to expenditures which are planned to be incurred in connection with environmental matters. And Mr. Speaker, I take pleasure in reporting to this House that a bill shortly entitled the Appropriation July 2016 to December 2017 Bill 2016 was considered by a committee of the stand was considered by the Standing Finance Committee, which is a committee of the whole House, and the bill was passed without any amendments thereto. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Madam Clerk.
Auditor General's report on financial and performance reporting. Ministries, portfolios, and offices for the years ended 30th of June 2013-14. Auditor General report on financial and performance reporting. Entities of public sector for the year ended 30th of June 2014. Auditor General report on financial and performance reporting. Statutory authorities and government companies for the years ended 30th of June 2013 and 2014. Report of the Standing Public Accounts Committee on the reports of the Auditor General and the financial and performance reporting. Ministries, portfolios, and offices for the year ended 30th of June 2013-14. Statutory authorities and government companies for the years ended 30th of June 2013 and 2014. And entire public sector for the year ended 30th of June 2014. To be laid on the table by the elected member for Northside, Chairman of the Standing Public Accounts Committee.
I call on the honorable elected member from Northside, Chairman of the PAC.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I beg to lay on the table of this Honorable House the following Auditor General's reports. The Auditor General report on the financial and performance of ministries, portfolios, and offices. The Auditor General's report on the financial and reporting performance of the entire public sector. The Auditor General report on the financial and reporting statutory authorities and government companies, and the PAC report on those reports.
So order. Does the member wish to speak there too?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I wanted to say, Mr. Speaker, that the public accounts took the view that because those three reports were so interrelated that we did one report on the three reports of the Auditor General, and to say that the public accounts endorses the seven recommendations of the Auditor General, as no evidence was uncovered during the committee's own investigations of the concerns raised by the Auditor General that did not support the seven recommendations. The PAC is pleased that management has accepted the recommendations of the Auditor General and has identified the agencies responsible for implementing these recommendations. And the PAC is also pleased that management has placed reasonable timelines on the implementation of these recommendations, and that evidence given as an update by both the Auditor General and the management indicated good progress. Mr. Speaker, the Public Accounts Committee wishes to draw the attention of government to the Standing Order 77, suborder 7, which reads, "The government minute shall be laid on the table of the House within 3 months of the laying of the report of the committee and of the report of the Auditor General to which it states. The PAC expects the government to honor the requirements of this standing order. The PAC expects that the government minute will show how the resources to complete the implementation of these recommendations by the Auditor General is being provided for in the 2016-17 budget." Thank you.
Madam Clerk.
Auditor General report on the government programs supporting those in need, Cayman Islands Government Needs Assessment Unit, May 2015. Report of the Standing Public Accounts Committee on the report of the Office of the Auditor General on the government programs supporting those in need, May 2015. to be laid on the table by the elected member for Northside, chairman of the Standing Public Accounts Committee.
I now call on the honourable elected member from Northside, chairman of the PSA.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I beg to lay on the table of this honourable house Auditor General's report on government programs supporting those in need and the PAC report on the Auditor General's report.
So ordered. Does the honourable member wish to speak there, Tom?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Speaker. To say that the PAC agrees with the findings and recommendations of the Auditor General in this report. The PAC is concerned that during the public hearings on the recommendations contained in the report, it was clearly demonstrated that much work needs to be done to address the concerns of the Auditor General. The PAC is particularly concerned that the emphasis by the Ministry seems to be concentrating on the perceived need for substantial, almost double additions to staff complement as a way to deliver services more efficiently and effectively. The PAC would like to suggest that a major overhaul of the procedures and policies to devolve authority and reduce the bureaucratic duplication that was clearly demonstrated in the public hearings may be a better use of government resource. The PAC is also concerned by the absence of any deadline by management to address these recommendations. The PAC would like to draw the government's attention to recommendations 1, 2, and 5 of the report. And Madam Speaker, once again, the PSC wishes to draw the attention of government to the need to respond to the PSC report in a government minute within the prescribed standing orders. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Madam Clerk.
Auditor General report on national land development and government real property, June 2015. Report of the Standing Public Accounts Committee and the report of the Office of the Auditor General on the National Land Development and Government Real Property, June 2015, to be laid on the table by the elected member for Northside, chairman of the Standing Public Accounts Committee.
Honourable elected member from Northside.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I beg to lay on the table of this honourable house the report of the Office of the Auditor General on national land development and government real property, and the Public Accounts Committee report on that report.
So ordered. Does the honourable member wish to speak there too?
Yes, Mr. Speaker, thank you. Once again, Mr. Speaker, I'd like to draw the PSC agrees with the findings and recommendations of the Auditor General in this report. PSC, Mr. Speaker, is particularly concerned with the responses from management and the unwillingness for the chief officers concerned to accept responsibility and accountability for the concerns expressed by the Auditor General in this report. The evasive and inadequate answers given by the chief officers during the public hearings held by the PSC on this report is of immediate and particular concern, as it suggests a lack of preparation. On at least two occasions, the Public Accounts Committee had evidence that did not support the answers given by the chief officers. The PSC notes with some disappointment that while management supported some of the recommendations of the Auditor General, no timelines were identified for completing the implementation of the recommendations. To be determined is not acceptable to the PSC as a definitive timeline for implementation. The PSC is concerned with the propensity and frequency with which the chief officers shifted the responsibility and authority to address the concerns of the Auditor General to other persons or agencies. PSC is further concerned with the chief officer's deliberate and persistent refusal to accept responsibility for issues which led to the Auditor General's recommendations during the public hearings. These evasive answers and shifting of blame often sail close to contempt for the process. The PSC would take the opportunity to invite the Deputy Governor to ensure that all chief officers and other civil servants who are summoned to give evidence to the Public Accounts Committee do so with clear and concise answers while being honest and factual to demonstrate respect for the process and the Public Accounts Committee. Again, Mr. Speaker, Public Accounts Committee wishes to draw to the attention of government the requirement of Standing Order 77, Suborder 7, and the PSC expects a response from the government identifying the resources being allocated for the implementation of these recommendations and in the time required by the, for the presentation of the government minute, that is 90 days. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Madam Clerk.
Auditor General report on management of travel and hospitality expenditures, May 2014. Report of the Standing Public Accounts Committee and the report of the Office of the Auditor General on the management of travel and hospitality expenditures, May 2014, to be laid on the table by the elected member for Northside, Chairman of the Public Accounts Committee.
Honourable member from Northside.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I beg to lay on the table of this Honourable House the report of the Office of the Auditor General on the management of travel and hospitality expenditures, May 2014, and the Public Accounts report.
So ordered. Does the Honourable Member wish to speak there at all?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the report of the Auditor General was carried out in Grand Cayman. The object of the audit was to determine whether in the period from the 1st of July 2009 to the 30th of June 2012, official travel and hospitality expenditures were properly managed in core government entities as defined in the Public Management and Finance Law 2012 revision to ensure value for money. With due regard to existing risks, responsibilities, and policies, the audit also considered significant transactions and their adherence to policies in the 6 months period after 30th of June 2012. The committee noted with concern that the scope of the audit carried out by the Auditor General was limited because the supporting documentation for travel and hospitality expenditures was very poor, in some cases non-existent, and the records in the accounting system unreliable. As a result, the Auditor General was not able to carry out all the audit procedures he had planned, thus limiting his ability to provide more information in his report of how these expenditures have been managed or qualify how much of the public resources were mishandled or wasted during the period covered by the audit. The committee agrees with and accepts the 11 recommendations made by the Auditor General throughout his report and summarized in Appendix 4. The committee believes that if these recommendations are implemented timely and consistently across the entire public service, it will provide a practical and cost-effective framework for managing official travel and hospitality expenditures, thus minimizing the risk of mishandling and abuse of public resources. The committee further noted the response provided by the Deputy Governor and acknowledged the significant efforts made by his office to address the recommendations made in this report. While much progress has been made, the committee noted with disappointment that recommendation number 2 regarding the development of a comprehensive hospitality policy has not been implemented as of the date of the public hearing, 25th of March, 2015. The committee believes that this policy is a key recommendation of the report and should be implemented as a matter of priority. The committee therefore urges the Deputy Governor to prepare this policy and implement it across the entire public sector. The committee also recommends that a further audit be undertaken either by the government's internal audit unit or the Auditor General to determine if the recommendations have been fully implemented and if the policies and procedures are operating effectively, efficiently, and as intended. And again, Mr. Speaker, we draw the attention of the government to the need to respond in a government minute. Thank you.
Madam Clerk.
Auditor General report on collecting government revenues, September 2015, report of the Standing Public Accounts Committee, and the report of the Office of the Auditor General on collecting government revenues, September 2015, to be laid on the table by the elected member for Northside, Chairman of the Standing Public Accounts Committee.
Honourable elected member from Northside.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I beg to lay on the table of this Honourable House the Auditor General's report on collecting government revenues 2015 and the Standing Public Accounts report on the Auditor General's report.
So ordered. Does the Honourable Member wish to speak there, Tom?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Speaker. The PAC endorses the 7 recommendations of the Auditor General, as no evidence was uncovered during the committee's own investigations of the concerns raised by the Auditor General that did not support the 7 recommendations. The PAC is pleased that management has accepted the recommendations of the Auditor General and has identified the agencies responsible for implementing these recommendations. The PAC is also pleased that management has placed a reasonable timeline on the implementation of these recommendations, and that evidence given as an update by both the Auditor General and management indicated good progress. Once again, Mr. Speaker, wish to bring to the attention of the government the necessity to respond in a government minute within 90 days. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Madam Clerk.
Auditor General report on government IT security, September 2015. Report of the Standing Public Accounts Committee and the report of the Office of the Auditor General on Government IT Securities 2015 to be laid on the table by the elected member for Northside, Chairman of the Standing Public Accounts Committee.
Honourable elected member from Northside.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I beg to lay on the table of this Honourable House the report of the Auditor General on Government IT Securities 2015 and the Public Accounts Report on the Auditor General's report.
So ordered. Does the Honourable Member wish to speak there at all?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the Public Accounts Committee agrees with and supports the recommendations of the Auditor General in this report. The PAC is pleased that management has accepted the recommendations and identified the agencies responsible for implementation, as well as placed an acceptable timetable on the progress. And once again, we remind the government of the need to respond in a government minute. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Auditor General report on major capital projects, building schools, May 2015, report of the Standing Public Accounts Committee, and the report of the Office of the Auditor General on major capital projects, building schools, May 2015. To be laid on the table by the elected member for Northside, Chairman of the Standing Public Accounts Committee.
I now call on the Honourable Member from Northside.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I beg to lay on the table of this Honourable House the report of the Office of the Auditor General on the major capital projects building schools, May 2015, and the public accounts report on that Auditor General's report.
So ordered. Does the Honourable Member wish to speak there at all?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The audit and report of the Auditor General was carried out in Grand Cayman. The objective of the audit was to determine whether the government managed the completion of the construction of the Clifton Hunter High School and the John Gray High School and the construction of primary schools within a management framework that ensured that value for money was obtained from these public investments. The Auditor General concluded in his report that, in his opinion, the Minister of Education failed to establish the management frameworks to ensure that value for money was obtained and it managed the projects poorly. The committee agrees with and accepts the two recommendations made by the Auditor General in his report and summarized in Appendix 2 to the report. The committee urges the government to implement the recommendations as a matter of priority, given the number of major capital projects that either have commenced or about to be undertaken. And once again, to remind the government of the statutory requirement for the government minute.
Madam Clerk.
Auditor General report on management of the nation building program, July 2015. Report of the Standing Public Accounts Committee on the report of the Office of the Auditor General on the management of nation building program, July 2015. To be laid on the table by the elected mayor for Northside, chairman of the Standing Public Accounts Committee.
Honorable elected member from Northside.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I beg to lay on the table of this honorable house the report of the Office of the Auditor General on the management of the Nation Building Fund, July 2015, and the public accounts report on that report.
So ordered. Does the honorable member wish to speak there at all?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The PAC wishes to draw the government's attention to the conclusions drawn by the Auditor General from his findings in the report. The PAC is particularly concerned that these conclusions are possible and strongly recommends that government take the necessary steps, including the implementation of the recommendations made by the Auditor General to prevent a reoccurrence. The PAC strongly supports the implementation of the recommendations contained in this report. The PAC is pleased with the assurance given by the Deputy Governor during the public hearings and believes the public and the committee can take some comfort by these public and recorded commitments. The PAC is also pleased that management has committed to completing the implementations of these recommendations by July the 1st, 2016. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Madam Clerk.
Mr. Speaker, just clear my indulgence, please. Mr. Speaker, and I want to, this is the last report, to thank the members of the Public Accounts Committee for their hard work and diligence. Not once did I have to cancel a meeting because we didn't have a quorum. I also wish to thank the staff of the LA for the efforts that they put in, given their shortage of resources to get these reports to the good position where I could table them today. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Madam Clerk.
Questions to honorable ministers and members of the cabinet.
I call on the Honorable Premier for the suspension of Standing Order 23, 7, and 8, and also eventually Standing Order 23, 6, allowing one member to ask more than three questions in the sitting.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'll try to remember all of that.
23, 7,
and 6. Mr. Speaker, I beg to move the suspension of Standing Order 23, 7, and 8. In order that question time may commence and continue beyond the hour of 11 o'clock. And I also move the suspension of Standing Order 23-6 in order that a member may ask more than three questions during a sitting.
Thank you. The question is that Standing Order 23-7 and 8 and 6 be suspended to allow questions after the 11 a.m. hour, and that a member can ask more than three questions in one sitting. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those against, no. The ayes have it. Standing Order 23, 6, 7, and 8 are accordingly suspended.
The elected member for Northside to ask Honorable Minister of Financial Services, Commerce and Environment, question number 6.
Honorable member from Northside.
Yeah. Mr. Speaker, I beg to ask the Honourable Minister of Financial Services, Commerce and Environment, can the Honourable Minister give an update on the new spear gun licensing regime?
Honourable Minister of Financial Services.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the answer, part five, dealing with permits and licenses of the National Conservation Law, has not yet been commenced. However, the Department of Environment and the National Conservation Council have been working through the preparation of a variety of licensing directives, including those necessary to give effect to the new spear gun licensing regime. The government is aiming to, or was, let's say, Mr. Speaker, given the difference in time from when the answer was filed, was aiming to commence part five of the law during this month. Mr. Speaker, just to add to that, we are simply awaiting the drafting of some additional regulations, particularly dealing with the environmental impact assessments, in order to allow parts five and seven of the National Conservation Law to be commenced at the same time. So I think those will be ready fairly shortly, and I would imagine it will be a matter of weeks before we are considering the actual commencement of both parts five and seven. Thank you, sir.
Are there any supplementary questions? Madam Speaker.
The elected member for Northside to ask Honourable Minister of Financial Services, Commerce and Environment, question number seven.
Honourable elected member from Northside.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I beg to ask Honourable Minister of Financial Services, Commerce and Environment the following question. Can the Honourable Minister give an update on the plans to address the sand offshore at Sandpoint?
Honourable Minister of Financial Services, Commerce and Environment.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the answer, the particular area of coastline in question has been experiencing the southward migration of a sand spit thrown up by Hurricane Ivan in 2004. This is not the first time we have seen this happen on this particular coastline, as we also experienced a similar phenomenon after Hurricane Gilbert in 1988. Mr. Speaker, in fact, the sand spit seen in certain 2004 aerial photography, which is available through the Lands and Survey database, reflects the remnant of the Hurricane Gilbert sand spit. The Ministry of Environment and the Department of Environment have been or have strongly recommended against registering these new boundaries on the basis that the accretion is not the result of normal coastal processes, but rather has resulted from a perturbation caused by hurricanes. And any temporary accumulation of sand at one of these coastal parcels today will migrate in a relatively short period of time. It is a widely held common practice within the islands that coastal boundaries cannot be recorded as fixed, but are rather recorded and registered as general boundaries, meaning the boundary of a coastal parcel will vary from day to day. For an in-depth discussion on the technicalities of the fixed boundaries versus general boundaries, I would of course defer to the Chief Surveyor or Director of Lands and Survey Department. We remain of the view that the boundaries of coastal parcels should remain being recorded and registered as general boundaries. We've expressed our views on this matter to the Ministry of Lands and the Director of Lands and Survey Department, whose responsibility it is ultimately to record and register each parcel boundary. Thank you, sir.
Honorable elected member from Northside.
Through you, Mr. Speaker, I wonder if the minister could say if the Department of Environment in their scientific analysis of the sand spit has given any consideration to the need to harvest the sand because of the threat that it poses on the entrance to the cove.
Honorable Minister for Commerce.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the Department of Environment has considered the issue. Of course, we have had a number of discussions on this and with the member as well. Mr. Speaker, there is a concern, as I indicated in my initial answer, that this is part of a natural process. If there is an attempt to interfere with that natural process, there may be consequences which are negative in respect of the environment. So we would wish not to have to run the risk of those negative consequences unless it becomes absolutely necessary to do so to protect and preserve access to the cove at Rum Point. I think I've indicated to the member in the past, sir, that we would certainly, the Department of Environment and the Ministry would certainly be supportive of a move to address this issue if that actually becomes a genuine threat. Thank you.
Honorable member from the North Side.
Through you, Mr. Chairman, would the minister consider that the entrance having been narrowed by more than one third of the original opening, whether that indicates that there's going to be a need to harvest the sand before it blocks it off completely?
Honorable Minister of Financial Services.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I think that is certainly a clear indication that there is a natural process ongoing which may well create an obstruction in terms of access to that that cove. Mr. Speaker, I'm familiar with that area for decades, and I know there has been over a period of time variations in the width of the entrance or mouth of this channel. Certainly, if it gets to the point, and it certainly could do so, that the access is being restricted, then we would certainly, as I said, support a move to address that by harvesting or dredging up some of the sand to allow continued proper access, reasonable access to that cove, sir. Thank you.
Madam Clerk.
The elected member from Northside to ask the Honourable Minister of Education, Employment and Gender Affairs, question number 8.
Honourable elected member from Northside.
Through you, Mr. Speaker, to ask the Honourable Minister of Education, Employment and Gender Affairs, can the Honourable Minister say who was awarded the scholarship sponsored by the Seamen's Association and what specialties are the two recipients studying?
Honourable Minister of Education.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The answer. Three applicants applied for the Seafarer Medical Specialization Overseas Scholarships. The association award is for two scholarships. The candidates have been interviewed for potential award, but the applicants have not been advised of any final decision. Mr. Speaker, to disclose the names at this time would not be appropriate as the candidates themselves have not been told. There will be a formal announcement at the end of June 2016. The specialties of the applicants include naturopathic and Western herbal medicine, family medicine, and hematology and oncology. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Madam Clerk.
The elected member from Northside to ask Honourable Ex Officio Member responsible for the portfolio of the civil service, question number 9.
Honorable member from North Side.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I beg to ask the honorable ex-officio member responsible for the portfolio of civil service, can the honorable ex-officio member say when the two non-government members of the Anti-Corruption Commission will be appointed?
Honorable Deputy Governor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, on the 1st of December 2015, Mr. Norman Borden, OBE, was appointed by Her Excellency the Governor as one of the two non-government members of the Anti-Corruption Commission for a five-year term. As members will be aware, with the passage of the Anti-Corruption Amendment Bill 2016, the composition of the Anti-Corruption Commission shall now consist of not less than five members appointed by the governor and such members. And such members shall be who, in the opinion of the governor, are of high integrity, are able to exercise competence, diligence, and sound judgment in fulfilling their responsibilities under the law, shall be residents of the islands and may include retired judges of the Grand Court or the Court of Appeal, retired police officers, retired justice of the peace or magistrates, chartered or certified accountants, attorneys at law of 10 or more years call, or retired attorneys at law, and such other persons as the governor considers qualified to be appointed. Mr. Speaker, Her Excellency the Governor has begun considering persons for membership on this commission and is in the process of finalizing those appointments. On the 10th of June 2016, Her Excellency the Governor assented to the Anti-Corruption Amendment Bill 2016 and it was scheduled to be gazetted on the 20th of June. The commencement order has been prepared and is expected to be brought to Cabinet shortly. It is expected that the Anti-Corruption Amendment Law 2016 will come into force on or about the 1st of July 2016, and at that time, Her Excellency the Governor will make a public announcement as to the appointments of the new members of the Anti-Corruption Commission. Thank you, sir.
Madam Clerk.
The fifth elected member for Georgetown to ask honorable ex officio member responsible for the civil service. Question number 10.
Honorable fifth elected member from Georgetown.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I beg to ask the honorable ex officio member responsible for the civil service the following question standing in my name. Can the honorable ex officio member advise what the plan for community policing is and how many community policing officers there are, and include the areas the police and approximately how many residents are covered in each area by one police officer?
Honorable Deputy Governor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I understand this question was asked and answered in the Finance Committee, but I wanted to make sure it was recorded here. The community policing strategy continues to be a key strategy for the Royal Cayman Islands Police Service. They are, however, understaffed in this particular area of policing, having a total of 14 neighborhood police officers who are allocated as follows. 8 officers allocated to Georgetown, 4 officers allocated to Bordentown, 2 officers allocated to West Bay, inclusive of school resource officers assigned to the 2 major high schools. The number of residents covered in each area by one police officer is as follows. 31,303 residents in Georgetown, 12,001 residents in Bordentown, 11,911 residents in West Bay. The future plans include, subject to an increase in personnel, one neighborhood police officer assigned.
Mr. Franz, I think the answer circulated is the wrong one. I think this is for the next one.
Community policing.
Sorry about that.
Thanks. I appreciate it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mr. Speaker, should I start over, sir?
Just 1 second till we circulate. Then.
Okay.
Honorable Deputy Governor, you can continue.
The number of residents covered in each area by one police officer is as follows: 31,303 residents in Georgetown, 12,001 residents in Bordentown, 11,911 residents in West Bay. The future plans include, subject to an increase in personnel, one neighborhood police officer assigned to each of the new electoral constituencies.
Honorable Madam Clerk.
Fifth elected member for Georgetown to ask the honorable ex officio member responsible for the civil service. Question number 11.
Honorable fifth elected member from Georgetown.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I rise to beg to ask the honorable ex officio member responsible for the civil service following question, standing in my name. Can an honorable ex-officio member say what the plan is to encourage and incentivize Caymanians to join the Royal Cayman Islands Police Service and detail career progression slash succession plans and training to get officers to the higher ranks in each?
Honorable Deputy Governor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The answer, the Royal Cayman Islands Police Force encourages and incentivizes Caymanians to join the Royal Cayman Islands Police Service by undertaking a targeted recruitment campaign aimed at Caymanians and permanent residents and persons married to Caymanians only, including a robust marketing initiative. Two successful campaigns have been undertaken thus far. The first group has successfully completed their two-year probation, and two officers have been selected for the RCIPS High Potential Development Scheme, which is aimed at fast-tracking those two officers to inspector rank. Another recruitment will take place within the calendar year. The Royal Cayman Islands Police Service details career progression succession plans and training to get officers to the highest rank as described above. Also, the two new superintendents have been tasked as part of their performance objectives and development to implement and develop a mentoring program throughout the ranks. Officers will continue to attend leadership training and overseas training on secondments.
Honorable elected member from East End.
Thank you, Madam Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I wonder if the deputy Governor can tell us if these plans were just recently put in place or when they were put in place.
Honorable Deputy Governor.
Mr. Speaker, could the member be specific in terms of what plans are you talking about?
Honorable Member for East End.
Mr. Speaker, it says the Royal Cayman Islands Service encourages and incentivizes Caymanians to join the police force. When was that done?
Honorable Deputy Governor.
Mr. Speaker, I'm just going back in time. I don't want to give the member inaccurate information. The program in which to have Caymanian own classes has something that has been going on for quite some time. However, I know in the last 2 years, maybe 18 months, there's been a renewed effort to get Caymanian only or persons married to Caymanians recruitment classes. And those are the two classes that I refer to in this answer.
Honorable elected member, please stand.
Mr. Speaker, if such is the case, I wonder if you can tell us why the police force has not even responded to a young man who was in finishing high school in England, who was born in this country, raised in this country, and expressed an interest in joining the police force. And to date, this is a year ago, so that 2 years needs to be shortened somehow. And to date, his parents have not even received a response.
Honorable Deputy Governor.
Oh, Mr. Speaker, I can't answer that question, sir. I don't have any information. I have no knowledge who the person is.
Honorable Member for East End.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Speaker, can the Deputy Governor give us an undertaking that he will check it out to find out what has caused young Caymanians who are very academically inclined, at least two who were coming out of high school and they expressed interest in joining the police force, and they have since only recently returned home and since gone to choose another vocation? Can he give us an undertaking to look into it, since there is a big plan and drive to recruit young Caymanians?
Honorable Deputy Governor.
Absolutely, Mr. Speaker. If the member would share the information with me, I'll be happy to look into that and to speak to the persons myself and to also investigate within the RSIP as to exactly what took place.
Honorable elected member for East End.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Speaker, I don't know if he wants it over this mic now, because, you know, the secret thing don't work too well down here.
I think he wanted you to give it to him. On the
secret?
Side. Well.
Okay.
Thank you. The honorable elected member for Northside.
Through you, Mr. Chairman, I wonder if the Honorable Deputy Governor could list the incentives that are offered for Caymanians to join. Is this something that is above and beyond the average? Their salaries are and their other benefits?
Honorable Deputy Governor.
Mr. Speaker, thank you. We recently upgraded the salaries. The government supported an increase in salaries for police constables. So that is that's one incentive. And I think the incentive is that we are actually targeting Caymanians. So we're running recruitment exercises where we are making it very clear that it's only Caymanians and those persons who are married to Caymanians who should be applying. So I've seen the campaign. We put pictures of our Caymanian officers on these posters. We go around to various places. The police asked their Caymanian officers to encourage other persons to their friends, the other Caymanians, to come in and join the RSIP. And like I said, we're seeing the success of that targeted campaign. I can certainly investigate further to see if there is additional incentives for Caymanians, but certainly the raise in base pay was, my understanding, was a real disincentive for Caymanians. And now that that has been raised, I expect to see further Caymanians joining the RCIPS.
I'll allow two more questions. Honorable elected member for Northside.
Through you, Mr. Chairman. So the recent salary increase offered to police was solely for Caymanians? And the second question would be, is there, otherwise it's not an incentive for Caymanians. Mr. Chairman, is any consideration being given to offer incentives as some of what we may have to pay for expatriate officers, like some kind of housing allowance or some additional training overseas as opposed to just local training, depending on their academic levels?
Honorable Deputy Governor.
Mr. Speaker, thank you. This salary increase was across the board for all constables, sergeants, inspectors. Caymanian officers do receive various allowances, including a housing allowance. And yes, in my substantive answer, I did say that there were plans to develop Caymanians by sending them overseas on various secondments, and I know that that is actively being progressed.
Madam Clerk.
The Honourable Leader of the Opposition, the First Elected Member for West Bay, to ask Honourable Premier, Minister of Home Affairs, Health and Culture, question number 12.
Honourable Leader of Opposition, Malta.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, perhaps this question was dealt with in Finance Committee, but so that we have it on record here, since at one point we were told they didn't have, by the councillor at least, they didn't have information. So question number 12, standing in my name. Can the Honourable Minister say what is the total agreement for the removal of tires from the Georgetown landfill? What was the tendering process used? What experience does the company who won the tender have in such projects? How many companies express interest in the tender? What time can we expect work to begin on the removal of tires? What is the intended use of the tires upon removal and the intended destination?
Honorable Premier.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, before I read the answer, I should say, although that has not been asked, that this was the fifth tender process that the government went through with respect to seeking to obtain a contract for the removal and disposal of the tires at the landfill. Mr. Speaker, the Minister of Health and Culture's conditional tender award agreement comprises the prompt processing on-site and removal of all the used tires accumulated at the Georgetown landfill, with used tires being also brought in from the Sister Islands landfills. The Minister of Health and Culture, through the Department of Environmental Health, conducted an open tendering process through the Central Tenders Committee. The Ministry of Health and Culture has issued a letter of intent to a local waste management company, which has teamed up with an international company with extensive tire recycling experience. Mr. Speaker, as I intimated in Finance Committee, the winner of the tender is Island Recycling. The Minister of Health and Culture received in total four tenders and one letter submission, the latter of which expressed interest in the potential use of a tire product. The Minister of Health and Culture expects that an actual contract will be signed next week, and the contractor will process the entire stockpile of tires landfilled in the Cayman Islands within a 12-month period. Mr. Speaker, I wish to explain that the written answer, which speaks to recommendations by CTC to award the contract, has been overtaken by events, and the contract itself will be signed next week. The intended use of the process tires is as tire-derived aggregate, and it is intended that this product will be used on islands by local developers who will use the TDA, as it is called, as a replacement to bringing in and using off-islands aggregate in their project site works.
Honorable Leader of the Opposition.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Can the minister say what was the process used? Was there a department committee that received the tenders, went through them, and then made a recommendation to finance committee? Sorry, to Central Tenders Committee.
Honorable Premier.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Yes, Mr. Speaker, there was a departmental tenders committee headed up by the director of the Department of Environmental Health, and they went through the tenders in the usual way and made the recommendations up to CTC.
Honorable Leader of Opposition.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, can the minister say whether the company has its own equipment, or are they using government equipment?
Honorable Premier.
Mr. Chairman, they're acquiring their own equipment. They're acquiring their own equipment.
So, Mr. Speaker, according to an FOI, in bidding for this job, now I don't know all the companies involved, you say like five or seven, five? That's not an entire question though. In complying with the bid document, did all the companies have to have the same criteria? In other words, did the company that got it had to have the equipment when they bid on it, or they got the bid and then were able to take that and get their equipment?
Honorable Premier.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, all companies were required to demonstrate that they had the wherewithal to get the required equipment. That includes the financial wherewithal.
Madam Clark, sorry.
And you say there were five companies, and Mr. Chairman, did all companies produce this wherewithal to get the required or the equipment that they would need? And were they given the same criteria in regards to what Central Tenders would have wanted them to provide to prove that they could do it? Did the company receiving the bid have the experience in the baling of tires? I think that's the correct terminology for the work that they're going to do to remove the tires. I think it's called baling
Shred.
No, bailing is the correct, but I guess they can shred it. I don't know. That's the information that I have gleaned. Anyway, those questions.
Mr. Bremer.
Mr. Chairman, I'm saying to off, I was saying off mic to the honorable leader of the opposition that you don't bail tires, the tires are being shredded. But to try to respond to his multi-pronged question, there were four bidders. Three were local and one was overseas. In addition, there was one letter submission expressing an interest in the potential use of the tire product, but that wasn't a proper tender. Of the four tenders received, two failed to meet the mandatory financial viability requirements and were therefore disqualified. All companies were required to meet the same criteria.
So, Mr. Chairman, question A, the company that got the tender has the capacity, experience to shred. They have been involved in that business before. And B, what is the value?
Mr. Premier.
Mr. Chairman, Island Recycling is an established recycling company in Cayman, Caymanian-owned company, and it is partnering with an experienced company overseas to carry out this particular project. The value of the contract is $1.245 million Cayman Islands dollars, which is based on processing an estimated 500,000 tires that are in the stockpile. That is an estimate. No one truly knows what the number of tires are.
The honorable member you said was trying to catch my ear.
What the number of tires is. Sorry, let me get my grammar right.
Mr. Speaker, in the last answer, the Premier says that the TDA is going to be used in lieu of developers bringing in aggregate. What kind of aggregate were developers given permission to bring in?
Honorable Premier.
Mr. Speaker, that's out of my league and way without out of this. What I can indicate to the member, if this helps him, the CTC insisted that the company who won the contract was able to show that they had or would have contracts locally to dispose of this TDA in an environmentally acceptable way. Otherwise, we'd wind up perhaps with a situation where we just transfer the problem from the landfill to somewhere else. So Davenport, which is a major developer of many projects in Cayman and has two projects on the way, has agreed to take a significant amount of the TDA for use in their projects, and the proposed Ironwood project has also similarly agreed with Island Recycling to take a portion of the TDA. That's really all I can answer because that's all I know. I don't know about what other aggregate government may have agreed to have developers bring in. That's beyond the scope of my knowledge and certainly beyond the scope of this question.
Honorable elected member, will you stand?
Mr. Speaker, that it's not beyond the scope of the, it might be beyond the scope of the question, but it wasn't beyond the scope of the answer. That the answer says that as a replacement to bringing in and using off island aggregate in their project site works. But any development in this country, there is sufficient aggregate on island to. So I don't know what kind of, I'm just trying to determine, Mr. Speaker, what kind of aggregate would have to be brought in to be used at a golf course.
Honorable Premier.
Mr. Chairman,
the member from North Side had a question.
Mr. Speaker, I said before I started the answer that I don't know the answer to that question. So
maybe you could give an undertaking to let them know what is proposed.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Speaker, this is way beyond the scope of my knowledge as the Minister of Health with respect to this. I don't know what other aggregate companies have been allowed or permitted to bring in. Perhaps that question should be directed to the Minister for Planning or Lands or something, but that's way beyond the scope of this. The point the answer is seeking to make is that this TDA will be used instead of other aggregate. That's the point.
Member from the outside.
Through you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I think the Premier referred to a number of times that the government had tried to get rid of these tires. If I recall, the other times, the government was asking persons to pay the government for the tires. What brought about the shift where we are now paying somebody to move the tires?
What's the Premier?
Mr. Speaker, simply because after five previous attempts, there were no takers.
Honorable member on the outside.
Through you, Mr. Speaker, it was my understanding that at least some, if not all of the other tenders were rejected because they were not offering to pay enough. Not that they hadn't offered to pay something, but here we are turning it completely around and now we are going to pay somebody to take them. Why didn't we just call one of the people who bid before and say we'll give it to you for nothing? You'd save $1.2 million.
Honorable Premier.
Mr. Speaker, with respect, we did all of that. I repeat, we tried not once, not twice, not three times, not four times, but five times. So the government is determined to remove what is a major environmental problem and issue and to deal with it. And we have reluctantly been driven to the conclusion after one tender, two tenders, three tenders, four tenders, five tenders of trying to persuade or to attract bidders to pay for the tires, that is not going to work. And that is why we have gone through this process, and even this process did not attract a vast number of bidders. In the end, there were only two who actually met the requirements. This is not the sort of stuff that people are falling over themselves to do, as our experience over the course of now years has demonstrated.
Honorable member from North Side.
Through you, Mr. Chairman, I see in the press today that Ironwood has received planning permission without an environment assessment. Can the minister give my constituents the assurance that these tires will not affect the only usable water lanes in the island, which is in my constituency and the constituency of East End, over which these tires will be used as fill?
Honorable Premier.
Mr. Speaker, Thank you, Mr. Speaker, for your indulgence. Mr. Speaker, as part of this whole exercise, we have involved the NRA, the Department of the Environment, and the Water Authority, and received the necessary assurances and guidelines with respect to where and how this TDA can be used as aggregate so as not to impact waterlands. And as the member from Northside will know very well, I have a personal vested interest in ensuring that the waterlands in his constituency and East End constituency are not damaged, because I do not want contaminants to water the plants on my farm. So my point, Mr. Speaker, is that I would have ensured that I was satisfied that what is being done is safe and environmentally sound.
I'll allow three more questions. Honourable Member from Northside, followed by the Leader of Opposition, followed by the Member from East End. You see the multi question.
Through you, Mr. Chairman, would the Honourable Premier and Minister of Health undertake to provide us with the written submissions from the Department of Environment, the Water Authority, and all those agencies that were considered and certified this as being of no harm?
Honourable Premier.
Mr. Chairman, I don't know that we have those certificates. But I know the process that has been gone through. I will check. Just one moment. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I've just been assured by the Deputy Chief Officer in the Ministry that we do have those in writing, and we can make them available to the member of Northside, who does not appear to be listening to me right now, but I'll still let him have them.
Honorable Leader of Opposition.
Mr. Chairman, I crave your indulgence to deal with the criteria. As I asked the question earlier, and I was told that this is not about bailing, but the criteria was given to the two companies, as far as I can tell on this paper. And the question, or the part, sorry? Mr. Chairman, if you want to take time, I can get the that's appendix, a summary of evaluation of used tires, tender bids. And in the criteria, it says experience with similar projects. It gives them maximum 25 points. Three or more similar projects, 25 points. Two to three similar, 20 points. And one similar project, 10 points. And the company stated, when they studied of similar projects, using, and I'm not going to call company names unless I'm forced to, but I don't like to do that, but using certain company that has been doing bailing of used tires and shipping from Guernsey to Mentine, UK, will need to provide final agreement of alliance partnerships. That is where I get the wording bailing, because they said here that they have that's the experience they had. But they seem to have got the points. The other company, no specific experience with similar projects as stated in their tender documents. The other, and I don't know, maybe they can explain that, but if he can't, I would certainly ask the Premier to get that information. The other question is, Mr. Chairman, whereas they said maximum point on the price per ton, maximum 25 points metric ton MTH, lowest price MTH 25 points, all other prices flow low to high to be
awarded points on a ratio to lowest price. Company A, $189 metric tons as fixed price, regardless of quantity of tires on site. Also, government to possibly pay $4 to remove tires from site, I guess. Bid estimate 1 million tires to be processed at the landfill. So they're going to use government site to do the processing. Company B, $2.9 million to process up to 2 million tires. Company stated that this is their fixed price, as they do not know the, I guess, actual metric ton of tires. Even with extended time, company registered that it is a fixed cost price for up to 2 million tires. Fixed rate does not allow for lesser quantities than 2 million without paying the bulk price. They would pay also to government the bulk price. Company A got, for the $189 per metric ton as a fixed price, 10 points. Company B, I guess the one that lost, got 0 points for up to $2 million for the company, for the up to 2 million tires. They got zero points. I will share this, but I suspect that the minister will have this in his own possession. And the question is, what was their experience in trading, that they have the equipment, they say they do, or they're going to get it? Two is, do they have experience in shredding, or they have experience in baling? Because that's what this bid document says. That was their answer. They got 10 points for it. The other ones got nothing.
Mr. Premier.
Mr. Chairman, I don't know if I can follow all of that, but
there it goes.
I realize what's happened is that the Leader of the Opposition has received representations from Shamrock Heights Development and Machinery Supply, Inc., who is the only other company which actually wasn't disqualified. They were, since this is where we're going, let's tell the whole story. There were five companies who initially indicated an interest. Island Recycling and Guernsey Recycling, which is the contract, is the company that won the contract. Cayman Waste Solutions, A Second Chance Recycling and Services Overseas, Shamrock Heights Development and Machinery Supply, Inc., and Ironwood Cayman Islands. Ironwood Cayman Islands submitted no bid, only a letter stating they would work with a successful company. So they weren't in the picture. There are a range of criteria: financial viability, public liability insurance, signed tender sheet, qualification statement, experience with similar projects, and then the price. The particular criterion that the Leader of the Opposition referred to is about experience with similar projects. The successful bidder was awarded 10 of a maximum of 25 points. The unsuccessful company, Shamrock Heights Development and Machinery Supply, Inc., received no points because they submitted no information with respect to specific experience with similar projects. None.
Mr.
Honorable Leader of Opposition.
Mr. Chairman, I'm wondering whether And I didn't do this in finance committee because the minister himself wasn't here, and the councillor was totally lost. And so I didn't pursue that. But I think I should read the information that I have since names have been called. And this letter comes from the lawyer and says exactly what the situation is. And Mr. Chairman, I can get you a copy of this so that...
How long is it?
It is...
Because we've been going here nearly half an hour on this one.
It is $1.2 million. I mean, if you want me to sit down, I will. Mr. Chairman, it's not going to get anywhere, but I don't want the wrong impressions to be, Mr. Speaker, to be left hanging. But the man, they never had, because they are with a company too, as I understand it from this letter. Both companies have an outside partner. One partner says that it has tremendous with such business. The other says they have it bailing. So I don't know how they've done it. I am not the Central Tenders Committee. I don't know what they are. I don't know. But the documentation here, which what I'm going to do now is to table so that members have it. I mean, it's already voted upon. As I said, I thought that I should ask those things because it left me wondering just what the process was. And I'm going to ask the Sarge to...
Okay, do that.
To do that, and I won't take the time up, Mr. Chairman.
Appreciate
to read
that.
Yeah, we won't get out here by 4:30. I had a PMSA.
The member from East End had a question.
And yeah, to lay it on the table once there's enough copies. Yeah.
Member from East End.
Mr. Speaker, just so I can say it, as the member, as the leader of the opposition has said, this contract has been awarded by CTC through the usual processes. This minister nor any other minister had anything to do with that. So the machinations and the decision-making of CTC is not something I could comment on.
Exactly.
Mr. Chairman, just want to say I wasn't pointing my finger at any minister, but there is a department process that seems to have been very close to certain aspects of that contract when you read the documentation. So that's why I'll lay it on the table.
Honorable member from East End, last question.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Speaker, the Premier said that the cost of $1.245 million was for 500,000 tires, based on 500,000 tires. I figured that out somewhere around $249 per tire. What happens if we have more than 500,000 tires there?
Honorable Premier.
Mr. Speaker, I'm advised that the contract contains provisions which allow for the event, or that in the event that there are more tires, that there can be, the company can continue to do so at a reduced rate, depending on how many more there are. In other words, the more tires there are, the lower the per tire cost the government will be.
The cost will go down if it's more. Yeah.
Member for East End. Final.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Speaker. Thank you for your indulgence. Mr. Speaker, 8 years ago maybe, I was told 10 years ago, that there were a million tires on the estimated. I bought the shredder. That worked for 5-6 years. Well, it broke down for 2-3 years, and it's fixed now, yes. And I know it's fixed now. So I don't think we got 500 or more, 500,000 out of it during that period. There is the potential that all those tires that are buried because of the weight, they have now gone into the ground. We need them out because that's potential problems for us. There is the potential that this could increase exponentially. Seriously, we could be looking at $2-3 million to rid ourselves of those tires. Are we comfortable that is the possibility because of the lack of counting of those tires? And we're paying more than we collected for them. And we didn't collect for all either, because that only started recently.
Honorable Premier.
Mr. Speaker, there were previous estimates, but the advice I have now is that the team is quite confident, or fairly confident, that the numbers are around that figure, around 500,000. The shred, well, I'm not sure where the member from East End, you know, where his advice came from. I suspect I know. I'm saying that I suspect that I know. But
you know
where his advice came from way back then. But the member, so I don't think there's much point in us arguing and debating, because we're speculating now about what the numbers are. The reality is that we have a problem with the number of tires that are there for a whole range of reasons, and this government is taking action to get rid of that problem. It may well cost more than the 1.245 million. We'll have to deal with that as the circumstances present themselves. But what I can say to the member from East End and the House generally is that we've gotten the shredder, which the member, when he was minister, member from East End, when he was minister, had acquired. We've got that back operational. And the plan is that once this huge volume of tires has been taken away and processed, that we won't get back in this situation again, because that smaller shredder, which is a much smaller shredder, will be capable of dealing with the tires as they come in, rather than allowing them to accumulate as they have since the year 2000.
Madam Clerk.
Statements by honorable members and ministers of the cabinet.
I've been notified of two statements. Honorable Premier. He wouldn't do that.
Mr. Speaker, as the House will be aware, our friends in the United Kingdom have cast their votes to leave the European Union in the referendum held yesterday. This referendum was a question for the United Kingdom and its voters but we all expected that the impact of a decision to leave Mr. Speaker, this referendum was a question for the United Kingdom and its voters, but we all expected that the impact of a decision to leave would be felt far beyond the shores of the United Kingdom and would have had political consequences within the United Kingdom. It was also expected that there would be uncertainty within financial markets. This has certainly proved to be the case, with Prime Minister Cameron advising this morning that he will be stepping down as Prime Minister by October, and a no-confidence motion being brought against the Leader of the Opposition, Jeremy Corbyn. As we have seen, the world markets are now trying to come to grips with the implications of the referendum result. There are also other ramifications that will continue to flow from this decision in the weeks and months ahead. Mr. Speaker, it is not clear whether the transition to a new Prime Minister will be an internal matter for the Conservative Party or whether the United Kingdom will face fresh elections in a few months. There is also the distinct likelihood of another Scottish independence referendum. Additionally, Northern Ireland, which voted to stay, will no doubt consider its options. These all point to the possibility of a breakup of the United Kingdom. Mr. Speaker, Cayman has certainly benefited over the years from the United Kingdom's link to the European Union in tangible and intangible ways. For example, we have been eligible for EU passports, which provide the ability to live, work, and travel freely within the European Union. Cayman and all of the overseas territories will need to follow closely the political and economic discussions and developments over the course of the coming days, weeks, and months. Of immediate concern, though, is the question of how any new UK government will view the overseas territories, particularly in the new construct of a United Kingdom that is no longer united. Over in the United States, a presidential election looms with the possibility of a radically different kind of political figure becoming the leader of the most powerful nation on earth. Without question, the world is in for a period of great uncertainty over the course of the next year and perhaps beyond. There will no doubt be some stormy waters to navigate before the new reality emerges and political and economic calm returns. In this sea of uncertainty, Cayman is an increasingly attractive place to live, work, invest, and do business. Mr. Speaker, the sound financial position of the Cayman Islands government and the growing strength of our economy make us an excellent option for businesses and investors looking for a safe haven amid the current political and economic turmoil. Even as we watch carefully the developments, we intend to seize the opportunities created by the current uncertainties to build on the economic success this government has already achieved. I am confident in the continued success of Cayman's economy. We have for years engaged with the world on matters relating to our financial services industry, and we will continue to do so. Our voice will be heard as we have strong links with many partner jurisdictions as well as international institutions. Businesses based in the Cayman Islands will continue to benefit from that, and they, like us, can remain confident in our future. There will be much to be done as the UK and the EU begin to determine a time frame to unwind their existing relationship and work toward putting in place new arrangements for future cooperation, trade, migration, and security. Some have said this process could take as much as 2 years to complete. And so for us in the Cayman Islands, the full impact of the leave decision will not be immediately known, as much will depend on what new arrangements will be made between the United Kingdom and the European Union. I expect to speak to the Minister for Overseas Territories, James Duddridge, early next week to get an indication on the immediate way forward and the perceived impact the decision will have on the overseas territories. In addition,
I will attend the pre-JMC meeting, that's the Joint Ministerial Council meeting, in the Turks and Caicos Islands next month with the other overseas territories leaders to discuss this issue in detail. Mr. Speaker, it is too early to make predictions or to be able to say what the full impact of the leave decision will be, but certainly it will be profound. It will impact not just the UK and its citizens resident there, but the overseas territories, Crown dependencies, and indeed the wider world. I will continue to monitor developments and engage with the United Kingdom government over the coming days, and as soon as the way ahead becomes clearer, I will make a further statement. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Mr. Premier. Subject to you and my colleagues throwing me around my ears, this has not surprised me. Those of us that believe in the Bible, this is no secret. All of this must come to pass. The European Union will come down to 10 nations. And as you see what has happened, this will be a snowball for the rest of those nations that pull away. All of this must come to pass before the end time. Forgive me for making that interception, but I just wanted to share. It's all there. It should be no surprise to none of us. Honorable Speaker, Minister for Education.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I rise today to make a brief statement in relation to the Ministry and Department of Labour and Pensions fulfilling the recommendations made in 2010 by the Office of the Complaints Commissioner in an own motion investigation report entitled Penny Pinching Pensions. I will also have another statement as it relates to another of its reports after this. This report, the Penny Pinching Pensions report, that is, contained a total of 21 recommendations, which was initiated by the Complaints Commissioner at the time, Ms. Nicola Williams. And it was her first own motion investigation report, which was deemed to be the most lengthy and detailed report in the history of the Office of the Complaints Commissioner at that time. In this report, the Complaints Commissioner Williams stated that, quote, "This own motion investigation was undertaken because it was one of the most pressing and obvious examples of systemic failure of a government entity, the National Pensions Office, and the national pensions law that underpins it," end quote. The three main concerns that led the commissioner to start this investigation were, one, non-compliant companies continuing to ignore the pensions law; two, whether the National Pensions Office had any real power to enforce the law; and three, the National Pensions Law not having been substantially revised since 2000. So in the 2010 report, the 21 recommendations made by the Commissioner Williams could be grouped into the following categories: legislative changes, public education and outreach, structural changes in regards to the National Pensions Office, now known as the Department of Labor and Pensions, and the National Pensions Board, interagency working relationships with government, and training. While I do not think it's necessary to go into detail in regard to each of the 21 recommendations, I do think, however, that it is relevant to state that within this report, the Commissioner highlighted in her findings that, quote, "the existing legislation applicable to pensions need substantial revisions, both to impose harsher penalties for non-compliance and to close loopholes that dishonest employers take full advantage of," end quote. I therefore would like to assure the members of this Honourable House that the National Pensions Amendment Bill 2016 that was unanimously passed on May the 4th, 2016, addressed all of the legislative recommendations contained within the Complaints Commissioner's report. The National Pensions Amendment Bill 2016 reflects the recommendations contained within the Penny Pinching Pensions Report in the following ways. It significantly increases fines, in some cases escalating up to $100,000, and introduces imprisonment terms for offenses in order to act as a true deterrent. It introduces an administrative fine regime as another enforcement tool to deal with employer noncompliance. It increases the power of the director, deputy director, and designated person to have the same powers, privileges, and immunities as conferred on the constable by the police law when performing their duties in relation to administering administrative penalties. It introduces a victimization protection clause for employees who make a disclosure to the Department of Labor and Pensions in regard to an employer's noncompliance of the law. It introduces more requirements for pension plans to educate and inform members, including the requirement for annual general meetings and an increase in the availability of pension statements, as well as notification from the administrator if their employer becomes delinquent. It also improves the disclosure of information to members by introducing the requirement for pension plan administrators to provide members with details on the investment returns and expense ratios of their pension fund, increase the frequency of member statements from annually to semi-annually, and allows statements to be issued electronically with a member's consent, and increases the access to the administrator's records on the pension plan from once a year to every 6 months, and establishes that the access is permitted to those persons stated in the law. It clarifies the roles between the Department of Labor and Pensions and the National Pensions Board by removing the duty of the National Pensions Board to administer the law and its regulations, and highlights its duty instead to carry out its functions as an appellate body as established under the law. Mr. Speaker, on the 21st of April 2016, the Ministry submitted its latest report to the Office of the Complaints Commissioner to update the office on the progress made on the outstanding recommendations. I am pleased to report that on the 5th of May 2016, the Ministry received a letter from the Acting Complaints Commissioner, Mrs. Brigitte von Gerhardt, which stated that the Office of the Complaints Commissioner determined that the Ministry had complied or substantially complied with the recommendations numbered 1 to 19 and 21, and that the Office of the Complaints Commissioner withdrew recommendation number 20 based on the review of the Ministry's current processes and policies, which do ensure that private sector companies awarded tenders within the Ministry are compliant with their pension contributions as well as statutory health insurance requirements. Given that the Office of the Complaints Commissioner has now closed the matters outlined in the Penny Pinching Pensions Report, I would like to provide for the record to this Honourable House the letter to the Ministry from the Office of the Complaints Commissioner stating this. The Ministry and the Department of Labour and Pensions had met with and reported to the Office of the Complaints Commissioner over the years to demonstrate that it had complied with 10 recommendations of the report. However, it was agreed by all parties that the vast majority of the outstanding recommendations were tied to revising the pensions legislation. I'm therefore proud, Mr. Speaker, that with the passage of the National Pensions Amendment Bill 2016, the Office of the Complaints Commissioner has deemed the Ministry and Department have now successfully complied with the Office of the Complaints Commissioner, and this report is now officially closed by their office. Mr. Speaker, in addition to the statement made by the I made on the compliance of the Office of the Complaints Commissioner's report, the penny pinching pensions, I would also like to make a brief statement in relation to the Ministry and Department of Labor and Pensions fulfilling the recommendations made in the 2012 report by the Office of the Complaints Commissioner in an own motion investigation entitled Danger Construction at Work. Initiated by the Complaints Commissioner at the time, Ms. Nicola Williams, this 2012 own motion investigation report contains a total of 13 recommendations. And Mr. Speaker, there's a typo in the statement being distributed. It's actually 13 recommendations. The terms of reference for this report was an investigation into the ability for the Department of Labor and Pensions, formerly the Department of Employment Relations, to effectively and properly oversee, inspect, and ensure health and safety at work for those involved in the construction industry as mandated under the applicable law and regulations. In this report, Complaints Commissioner Williams stated that the reason for the investigation into this area was as follows, quote, the construction industry is in a category of its own. It is a high-risk industry, and there is no price that can be placed on human life. Of all the work the department undertakes, any failings on their part in this area have the potential to be the most damaging to its reputation, end quote. The 13 recommendations made by Commissioner Williams can be grouped into the following categories: legislative changes, ensuring proper training and equipment is available to labor inspectors, structural, staffing, and administrative recommendations in regard to the department and its employees, increased government interagency collaboration to improve the culture of compliance, and recommendations to protect construction industry employees and whistleblowers. Mr. Speaker, over the course of the years since the publication of the report, the Ministry and Department has worked in collaboration with the Office of the Complaints Commissioner in order to comply with the recommendations of the report. Again, while I do not think it's necessary to describe in detail the 13 recommendations made, I will summarize to the members of this Honorable House that the 13 recommendations made in the original report, only four were deemed to be outstanding as of 2016. On the 21st of April 2016, the Ministry submitted its latest report to the Office of the Complaints Commissioner to update the Office on the progress made on these outstanding recommendations. I am pleased to report that on the 20th of May 2016, the Ministry received a letter from the Acting Complaints Commissioner, Ms. Brigitte von Gerhardt, which stated that the Office of the Complaints Commissioner determined that the Ministry has complied or substantially complied with the four outstanding recommendations, and therefore, as of that date, the file would be closed on this report. Given that the Office of the Complaints Commissioner has now closed the matters outlined in the Danger Construction at Work report, I would like to provide for the record of this Honorable House the letter to the Ministry from the Office of the Complaints Commissioner stating this. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Madam Clerk.
Personal explanations.
The Honorable Leader of the Opposition has indicated he wants to make a brief personal explanation.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Speaker. Everybody's calling you Chairman since we just come out of Finance Committee. I'm sure you will forgive us for that error. Mr. Speaker, according to today's Compass editorial, it seems the Compass comes to pass its editorial judgment again on our work here. Their Friday editorial speaks about speculation and slippery slopes. Madam Speaker, Mr. Speaker, the matter of how an MLA speaks in Finance Committee is predicated on what the subject is. Some of us speak with passion more than others do, and it's because some here get more heat than others get from constituents on matters affecting them. I have been in here for over 30 years, and I have been inundated at times with complaints from civil servants. I choose very carefully what to speak about, seek information on, or which complaint to put into the public domain. However, Mr. Speaker, we do have a constitutional responsibility in Finance Committee as we do elsewhere. The line we must walk as elected representatives, when we question policy, is a fine line, but it is constitutional. We can't tell managers who to fire or hire, and we have not sought to do that. But under policy, which we spend or pay millions of dollars to get, we can question what they do. That is not a slippery slope. whether it is my constituent or a civil servant from Georgetown. When a civil servant feels so aggrieved, so helpless at their personal plight, or what they see as abuse in their work environment, which they have been unable to get an understanding about, then their recourse, they feel, is to speak to the elected representative. Then we, as the elected representative, must exercise discretion about what and how we question. We do know that matters under discussion in the court cannot be discussed here or in any public arena. But our bound duty is to question civil service matters because money is being spent. Mr. Speaker, when the accounts are not done, which Compass and other media complains in their editorial about, must we not question why the accounts are held up? So, Mr. Speaker, the media have a right to complain time and time again, sometimes in caustic manner also, but elected representatives don't have that right. Don't we have a right to question what the total bill is for the country when there is 31 civil servants on paid leave and we don't even know if there are criminal charges? Is that not expenditure? When there's a case of a contracted officer being given a promotion before a Caymanian qualified is given an opportunity to apply for that position, and they can't get help within their ranks, is it wrong for us to be told when it is brought to our attention as elected officials why such a promotion was given? So the Compass or anyone else can say that they don't want a civil service tied to a particular politician, as the deputy governor said, or particular politicians the other day. I don't want them tied to any politician, and that's why over the years I've stayed out of their affairs. So the Compass says it can speculate what goes on behind closed doors. It is exactly that, Mr. Speaker, why we must ask questions. We do not want to speculate. I have learned many lessons about speculation only because I was not told the truth. And I have paid and is paying a high price because of speculation, and we should not have to speculate as elected representatives in this House or in Finance Committee. I want to say to the Compass editorial board, speculation in the agreeing to government expenditures policy is not something elected officials should have to do. When we come here to vote for a budget, we want to know, Mr. Speaker, that all channels are clear, that there are very little gaps, if any, in what we are being told about the work that our civil servants must do, that chief officers are not treating one civil servant as a buddy and best friend and putting stumbling blocks in the career paths of qualified, willing, and able Caymanians. What kind of representative, Mr. Speaker, would we be if we are complained to and cannot get redress to the problem? Then to sit back and say there is a wall, so I can't say anything? I shouldn't ask the probing questions that enlightens the cause or action of any situation? What kind of representation would that be? I have been very careful in my 30-odd years here, and I've taken many unjustified blows because a person was put on leave and it is pounced upon and declared publicly and to families it is Mekiwa who did that. That has gone on too long, and if we don't ask questions in Finance Committee, people will not know. Finance Committee is for that purpose of examining the estimates and approving them as needs be. Examining, Mr. Speaker, don't mean looking at them and voting yes or no. We are to ask questions. We must clarify and dig for more information within the rules if we are not satisfied with the answers given. I agree with the compass that it is not appropriate for members of Finance Committee to go beyond the bounds of our system of government, but they need to understand, and those officials in this House need to understand, that at the same time, we are charged with the constitutional duty to see that policy is carried out, that expenditure is carried through as is contained in the estimates, and variations thereto are correctly explained and reported to Finance Committee. If that process is to carry out fairly, then questions must be asked of the managers and overseers, such as the Deputy Governor, or the Attorney General, or the Finance Committee Chairman, or ministers, who must answer in this House or Finance Committee. Compass ought not, Mr. Speaker, to report small pieces of what is said here. No newspaper should do that without giving a fair and balanced sufficient amount of information so that the public we serve can fully understand what their representatives are doing in such arenas as our Finance Committee. Mr. Chairman, I thank you very much for your indulgence, and I have the House for loving me that personal explanation on what the Compass wrote in their editorial.
We have now passed the hour 4:30. I now call for the suspension of standing order 10-2 that the House continues after 4:30 p.m.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I move the suspension of standing order 10-2 that the House may move past the hour of interruption, and we'll continue till about 6 o'clock and see where we get to today. Hopefully we can finish up the rest of the work.
The question is, does standing order 10-2 be suspended to enable the business of the House to continue beyond the hour of 4:30 p.m.? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those against, no.
No.
The ayes have it. The House will continue beyond 4:30
suspension. P.m. Can we take a vote, Mr. Chairman? Mr. Chairman, forget the
thank you.
Forget the vote check. I withdraw my request.
Granted. Madam Clerk.
Obituary and other ceremonial speeches?
None.
Rising on matter of privileges?
None.
Government business? Bills. Third reading. The appropriation, July 2016 to December 2017, Bill 2016.
I call on the Honorable Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I beg to move that a bill entitled the appropriation, July 2016 to December 2017, Bill 2016. Be given a third reading and passed.
The question is that a bill shortly entitled the appropriation July 2016 to December 2017, Bill 2016, be given a third reading and passed. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those against, no. The ayes have it. The appropriation bill July 2016 to December 2017, Bill 2016, has been read a third time and is passed. Madam Clerk.
Mr. Speaker, sorry, I just pursuant to the statements that I just made, although the letters were attached to the statements distributed, I just want to make sure that the letters that accompany the statements are formally tabled on the floor of the House, if that is okay with you, to make sure that we follow the procedure of tabling.
Okay, I just assumed they were attached.
They are attached.
So ordered.
These are both of the statements, which are attached to all of the statement, both of the letters.
So ordered, Minister, that it be laid on the table of this Honorable House.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
First readings. First readings. Parliamentary Pension Amendment Bill 2016.
The bill has been deemed to have been read a first time and is set down for a second reading.
The Proceeds of Crime Amendment Bill 2016.
The bill has been deemed to have been read a first time and is set down for a second reading.
The Public Service Management Amendment Bill 2016.
The bill has been deemed to have been read a first time and is set down for a second reading.
The Public Service Pension Amendment Bill 2016.
The bill has been deemed to have been read a first time and is set down for a second reading.
The Nonprofit Organization Bill 2016.
The bill has been deemed to have been read a first time and is set down for a second reading.
The Confidentiality Information Disclosure Bill 2016.
The bill has been deemed to have been read a first time and is set down for a second reading.
Second readings, the Parliamentary Pension Amendment Bill 2016.
I call on the Honorable Deputy Governor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I beg to move the second reading of a bill entitled the Parliamentary Pensions Amendments Bill 2016.
So ordered. The bill has been duly moved. Does the mover wish to speak thereto?
Yes, Mr. Speaker, this is a fairly straightforward amendment, so that my remarks will not be that long. Mr. Speaker, by way of background, the Parliamentary Pensions Law governs the pension benefits for members of our Legislative Assembly and speakers. In order to qualify for pension benefits under the Parliamentary Pensions Law 1984, members of the Legislative Assembly and speakers were required to serve 2 full parliamentary terms or for periods in aggregate of not less than 6 years. Mr. Speaker, via the Parliamentary Pensions Law 2004 and carried forward to the current legislation, namely the Parliamentary Pensions Law 2010 revision, the qualification criteria was amended under Section 20 to allow members of the Legislative Assembly and speakers to be eligible for a parliamentary pension benefit after only 1 full parliamentary term. Mr. Speaker, as an amendment to the, let me start over. Mr. Speaker, as the amendment to the eligibility criteria was not retroactive, there are former members of our parliament and speakers who do not qualify for a parliamentary pension benefit. The period of service which is foreseen to be impacted by the amendment is between the 1st of October 1959, the earliest date of eligible service recognized in the original Parliamentary Pensions Law 1984, and the 23rd of August 2004. This bill, Mr. Speaker, seeks to bridge the gap created during the various revisions of the Parliamentary Pensions Law and allow former members of the Legislative Assembly and speakers otherwise ineligible to qualify for pension benefits, which they would have been entitled to had they served in more recent times. Mr. Speaker, I now will discuss the proposed amendments to Section 20 of the Public Service Pensions Law 2010 revision. Amendment to Section 20. It is proposed that Section 20 of the Parliamentary Pensions Law 2010 revision is amended to recognize those members of the Legislative Assembly and speakers who retired prior to the more generous provisions applying. To reiterate once again, the period of service which is foreseen to be impacted by the amendment is between the 1st of October 1959 and the 23rd of August 2004. Mr. Speaker, I just want to reiterate that. I've heard all sorts of allegations on the radios and elsewhere that members of this parliament are voting themselves additional benefits. I want to make it very clear and say it repeatedly that that's not the case. This particular amendment is dealing with past members of our parliament. Yeah. Mr. Speaker, this amendment is likely to result in approximately five former members of the Legislative Assembly and speakers qualifying for a monthly pension benefit of $1,000, which would be paid from the Parliamentary Pensions Plan. Mr. Speaker, I humbly invite all members of this Honorable House to lend their support to this bill, and in doing so, to recognize and dignify the service of our fellow Caymanians who formerly served in the House for the betterment of these Cayman Islands. I thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Does any other member wish to speak? Does any other member wish to speak? If no other member wishes to speak, does the mover of the bill wish to exercise his right of reply?
Mr. Speaker, no, sir, just to thank all the members for their tacit approval, thank you, or support.
The question is that a bill shortly entitled the Parliamentary Pensions Amendment Bill 2016 be given a second reading. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those against, no. The ayes have it. The Parliamentary Pensions Amendment Bill 2016 has been given a second reading.
The Proceeds of Crime Amendment Bill 2016, second reading.
Honorable Attorney General.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I beg the leave of this House to move the second reading of a bill, the long title of which is a bill for a law to amend the Proceeds of Crime Law 2014 revision, to make changes necessary for compliance with the international standards relating to the prevention of money laundering, terrorist financing, and proliferation financing, and to provide for incidental and connected purposes.
The bill has been duly moved. Does the mover wish to speak there at all?
Yes, Mr. Speaker. Thank you. With your leave. Mr. Speaker, honorable members would be aware that the Cayman Islands recently concluded its national risk assessment as a precursor to the fourth round of mutual evaluation review by the Caribbean Financial Action Task Force, which is set, Mr. Speaker, to take place during the second quarter of 2017. One of the revelations of the national risk assessment exercise was that certain provisions in a number of pieces of legislation, including the Proceeds of Crime Law, require some tweaking, Mr. Speaker, in order to ensure continuing compliance with the revised 40 Financial Action Task Force recommendations. Accordingly, the bill before this House is aimed at addressing some of the issues identified by the National Risk Assessment as it relates to the Proceeds of Crime Law. Mr. Speaker, for completeness, I should remind this House that the upcoming round of mutual evaluation will be based on the methodology for assessing technical compliance with the Financial Action Task Force 40 recommendations and effectiveness of anti-money laundering, combating financing of terrorism systems. Technical compliance, Mr. Speaker, contemplates that Cayman have in place laws, guidance notes, administrative systems, etc., that are consistent with the FATF 40 recommendations. However, the effectiveness component of the methodology will be benchmarked against what is referred to as the 11 immediate outcomes. An example, Mr. Speaker, of such one such outcomes is immediate outcome one, which states that countries need to demonstrate that money laundering and terrorist financing risks are understood, and where appropriate, actions coordinated domestically to combat money laundering and financing of terrorism and proliferation. Mr. Speaker, this initiative that is in train, that is the preparation for the upcoming review, is being done in coordination with the Ministry of Financial Services. And as members would have heard during the budget debate and through speech contribution by the Honorable Minister of Financial Services, his ministry is at full throttle in helping to coordinate the preparations for the review. I certainly would therefore wish to thank him and as well as the government for the commitment in support of this initiative, Mr. Speaker. Indeed, in March of this year, the government allocated almost $2 million to help to enhance the effectiveness of the relevant competent authorities to undertake the preparations. Mr. Speaker, the proposed changes to the bill, as I said, are aimed at strengthening the Cayman Islands anti-money laundering framework in a way that will ensure full compliance with the 40 recommendations. And so the changes in the bill are as follows. Clause 1, of course, Mr. Speaker, sets out the short title. Clause 2 seeks to amend Section 2 of the Proceeds of Crime Law and inserts the definition of the phrase relevant financial businesses into the law itself, Mr. Speaker. It was formally included in a schedule on page 136 of the law. This now puts it in section 2 of the law, which is the definition section. Mr. Speaker, clause 3 amends section 4 of the principal law so that the powers, function, and duties of the financial reporting authority will now also include monitoring compliance with regulations prescribing anti-terrorism financing and proliferation financing measures. The clause allows for the cabinet to assign the monitoring of compliance with anti-money laundering measures for relevant financial businesses and which are not currently monitored by CIMA. Those monitoring functions will be assigned by cabinet to a public sector body or a self-regulatory body. Clause 4, Mr. Speaker, this amends Section 5 of the principal law so that the chief officer or the chief officer's designate will now become the deputy chairperson of the anti-money laundering steering group. The clause also makes provision for the inclusion of the director of public prosecutions and the chief officer, a director of the relevant government department regulating compliance of designated non-financial businesses and professions. And we're talking here, Mr. Speaker, about the chief officer or the director in charge of DCI. The clause also permits the steering group, Mr. Speaker, to set up committees to implement the policies of the steering group itself. Mr. Speaker, Clause 5 amends Section 45 of the Proceeds of Crime Law so that it allows for an exemption to a restraint order, thereby enabling relevant legal aid payments. What does that mean, Mr. Speaker? It means that where a person's assets has been restrained by the court, and that person is granted legal aid to legal representation, the court may make an order that the legal aid fund be reimbursed from the assets that have been restrained. Clause 7, Mr. Speaker, this clause amends Section 138 of the Proceeds of Crime Law so that the Financial Reporting Authority may, in addition to making annual disclosures to the Cayman Islands Monetary Authority, we now also be able to make such disclosures to the Tax Information Exchange Authority where necessary. Clause 8, Mr. Speaker, of the bill amends Section 145 of the Proceeds of Crime Law so that regulations made thereunder can contain an increased amount for penalties that can be imposed. At the moment, Mr. Speaker, I think the law provides that regulations can only contain penalty of about $6,000. The amendment will increase that to $250,000. So the regulations can say, for example, that a breach of a particular provision can attract a penalty of up to $250,000. Clause 10 of the bill inserts a Schedule 6 into the principal law, into the proceeds of crime law, which lists the activities falling within the definition of relevant financial businesses. And the modification made, Madam, Mr. Speaker, designed to make the definition compatible with the 40 recommendations of the FATF as far as reasonably practicable. And Clause 11, which is the final clause I'd like to speak to, it inserts a provision into the Proceeds of Crime Law which brings the amendment to Section 45 of the principal law into force retroactively. And this, just for clarity, Mr. Speaker, what this is saying is that where a person has been granted legal aid and that person has assets that have been restrained, the court can make an order that the legal aid fund be reimbursed out of the restrained asset. And this provision is saying that the amendment will cover cases that have been dealt with prior to the amendment of this law. I thank you. I commend this bill to honorable members of this House. Thank you.
Does any other member wish to speak? Does any other member wish to speak? If no other member wishes to speak, does the mover of the bill wish to exercise his right of reply?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, thanks to honorable members for your support. Thank you.
The question is that a bill shortly entitled the Proceeds of Crime Amendment Bill 2016 be given a second reading. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those against, no. The ayes have it. The Proceeds of Crime Amendment Bill 2016 has been given a second reading. Madam Clerk.
Public Service Management Amendment Bill 2016.
Calling the Minister of Financial Services. Oh, beg pardon. On that, Honorable Deputy Governor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I beg to move the second reading of a bill entitled the Public Service Management Amendment Bill 2016.
The bill has been duly moved. Does the mover wish to speak there at all?
Yes, Mr. Speaker, thank you. Mr. Speaker, I rise to present the Public Service Management Amendment Bill 2016. By way of background, the Public Service Management Law governs civil service human resources matters, including terms and conditions of service, and outlines the benefits available to civil servants. One such benefit is the provision of pension benefits. Mr. Speaker, the Cayman Islands government continued to take steps to modernize its approach to civil service terms and conditions generally, but particularly to public service pension benefits. The following reforms have been made. The introduction on the 10th of July 1980 of the defined benefit plans to permanent and pensionable employees, and the introduction on the 1st of January 2000 of the defined contribution plan, which made pensions universally available to all public servants, i.e. including those Caymanians and non-Caymanian employees who were previously not on permanent and pensionable terms. Mr. Speaker, a key tenet of the proposed pension reform is to increase the normal retirement age within the civil service from age 60 to age 65. Based on numerous consultation meetings held both in Grand Cayman and Cayman Brac, civil servants have expressed strong support for the opportunity to work longer, particularly as existing staff will retain the ability to retire early if they so choose. Mr. Speaker, this bill therefore seeks to incorporate into amendments to the Public Service Management Law 2013 revision the necessary perimeters to implement an increase in the normal retirement age from age 60 to 65 for civil servants. Mr. Speaker, this change, as I have said before, has overwhelming support. But our employees, and in particular younger employees, have also expressed concerns about what impact it will have on their future promotion opportunities. Mr. Speaker, in anticipation of the law changing, we have relaxed our requirements and retained a growing number of persons at or above age 60. The result is that between 2014 and 2015, the average age within the civil service has grown from 42 years to 43 years. Persons at or above age 60 now represent a little over 5% of our workforce. Some 25%, Mr. Speaker, of the civil service is between ages 50 to 59. The result, Mr. Speaker, is that we have a very seasoned and experienced workforce, and I believe our work product benefits from this fact. However, we need to balance our workforce planning and with creating opportunities to attract new talent and to retain talent which is high performing and ought not to be on the rise. You will recall during Finance Committee, it was agreed that succession planning must and will be an area of focus over the next 5 years. As such, we need to not only retain experienced talent that can groom future civil service leaders, but also to create opportunities for emerging leaders to be promoted and for inspiring leaders to be hired into the civil service. As such, there have been two changes included within this amendment law bill to specifically facilitate succession planning. The first allows for government-initiated transfers where I, as Deputy Governor and Head of the Civil Service, will be able to transfer a person in a key managerial or technical role in order to facilitate a qualified Caymanian being promoted. In such circumstances, the existing manager or technocrat in a key role will still have their salary protected as the move was unilateral. It is expected that such moves will be by their nature temporary, as existing managers who are transferred should be approaching retirement or on fixed-term contracts. We appreciate concerns that this may increase cost to the public, and as such, the safeguards that exist in the draft law allows that only I, as head of the civil service, must make such a transfer. The regulations will further specify that in making such a transfer, a person who is being disciplined for poor performance will not be eligible to benefit from such a transfer. So, Mr. Speaker, we are keen to use this tool only in very specific and necessary circumstances. The second tool, which allows succession planning, Mr. Speaker, can be initiated by employees who wish to take phased retirement. Mr. Speaker, the civil service is undergoing tremendous change, and managers and technocrats have to facilitate this change and still maintain a challenging agenda of normal work activities. At a leadership conference earlier this week, we asked leaders across the civil service to make a personal commitment to driving this change and to deliver results with a sense of urgency. We may find, Mr. Speaker, that for various reasons, we may have persons who are eligible to retire but are not ready to retire, perhaps for financial reasons, but who also do not desire to continue to drive such a change from a leadership role. In those cases, persons may opt to request a lesser playing role, a lesser paying role, if one is available. They may augment their take-home pay by being able to access their pensions. It is anticipated that over time, as existing contracts expire, this will be the only way that civil servants will draw both a salary and a pension at the same time. This will be allowed in future only where the employee offers and the managers accept to move an employee to a lower paying position. Where an employee initiates this request, their salary is not protected, but they are allowed to access their own pension funds to make up the difference, and so their salary remains. This, Mr. Speaker, frees up roles for Caymanians to be promoted. We are currently pursuing policies to tightly manage headcount, to retain persons approaching retirement age, and to attract new talent to the civil service. The only way to achieve this without creating massive growth in total headcount is to be creative in the ways that we create promotional opportunities for our staff. The proposals regarding transfer is meant to allow legal framework greater flexibility to both the employee and the employer to move around the civil service, particularly to facilitate succession planning and career planning for older staff. Mr. Speaker, I know that some honorable members in this House may argue that the civil service should not even have a statutory retirement age for work. And I will tell you, Mr. Speaker, that there is some support for this even among our own senior policy advisors. However, we believe that we have to take incremental steps to ensure that the improvements we have made since 2008 to decrease total headcount by 11% within the civil service is not completely reversed in such a few short years because we have so many moving parts. Mr. Speaker, we are still strengthening our results on workforce planning, performance management, and accountability, and on identifying ways to manage our overall size and cost. We must be measured in our approaches at this time. Our organization simply isn't ready to completely do away with a statutory retirement age. Having said that, the public service management law has always facilitated persons being rehired who are above retirement age. In June 2015, we had some 175 persons who were over retirement age, and I expect this number to grow. We need to carefully plan for this and to mitigate other consequences, even as we seek to maximize the benefit of retaining knowledgeable staff. Mr. Speaker, I will now go through the proposed amendments to the Public Service Management Law 2013 revision. Amendment to Section 2, Definitions and Interpretations. These simply repeal some defunct references such as the Portfolio of Internal and External Affairs and the Portfolio of Finance and Economics. Inserting a definition for early retirement age which preserves existing staff eligible for early retirement at age 50 but requires future hires to work until at least age 55 before being able to retire early. Inserting a definition of normal retirement age being age 65, and inserting a definition of participant and inserting a definition of remuneration band. Amendment to Section 9, Appointment of Official Members. It is proposed that Section 9.4 of the Public Service Management Law 2013 is amended to replace references to retirement age, i.e. 60, with a reference to the normal retirement age, i.e. 65, throughout the sections of the law pertaining to the employment of official members. Insertion of Section 20A, Transfer of Employees to facilitate succession planning. It is proposed that the Public Service Management Law 2013 revision is amended by inserting after Section 20 a new section called Section 20A, which provides the head of the civil service with the ability to facilitate transfers between civil service entities. Currently, this can only happen for ministerial rearrangements, which normally happens after an election or by a chief officer where the transfer is within the same ministry or portfolio. Amendments to Section 26, Procedure for Appointing Chief Officers of Ministries and Portfolios. Mr. Speaker, it is proposed that Section 26.3 of the Public Service Management Law 2013 revision is amended to replace references to retirement age, i.e. age 60, with reference to the normal retirement age, i.e. age 65, throughout the section of that law. Amendment to Section 41, procedures and requirements for appointment. Mr. Speaker, it is proposed that Section 41 of the Public Service Management Law 2013 revision is amended to address staff concerns that raising the retirement age could frustrate succession planning. This clause amends Section 11 of Section 41 of the law by repealing Section 11 applicable to the reappointment of a person who has attained age 60 to instead refer to the normal retirement age, which is 65, allowing an appointing officer to reappoint a staff member who opts for partial retirement, i.e. to retire and earn a salary and pension by taking a lesser paying job without the need to go through open recruitment. I think that is very important. And inserting after Section 14, a new clause 14A, which allows the head of the civil service to initiate transfers of persons holding key managerial and technical roles where a Caymanian has been identified through succession planning to take over such role. Amendment to Section 42, basis of employment of staff. It is proposed that Section 42 of the Public Service Management Law 2013 revision is amended to address the basis of employment when a person is transferred by repealing subsection 4 and replacing it with text which allows a civil servant to transfer from one entity to another with uninterrupted service. As a result of the head of the civil service making the move to facilitate succession planning, the transfer person's terms and conditions are preserved versus as a result of the employee requesting to be transferred to a position of a lower salary grade in order to partially retire and claim a pension. Once this bill is passed, Mr. Speaker, Cabinet will issue amendments to the Personnel Regulations 2013 revision to give effect to the applicable amendments to the Public Service Management Law. Mr. Speaker, I want to also advise this Honorable House that I intend to bring a committee stage amendment. We have had representations from members of the Royal Cayman Islands Police to say that this law doesn't apply to them and they are eager for it to do so. We have had many consultations with them. We believed that we would have to bring a separate amendment under the police law, but our clever Attorney General has come up with a way of doing that with an amendment to this law here. So we will put that forward, and we have spoken to the members of the RCIP, and they are very happy that this is being done now as opposed to later. Madam Speaker, this is an important step for all of us in the civil service and RCIPS, that an increase in the retirement age could positively impact talent management and morale within the civil service. It is also recognized that this Honorable House recently passed a bill to amend the National Pension Law 2012 revision to raise the retirement age in the private sector. So it's important that we're all, both public sector and private sector, playing by the same rules. That was a mandate given to us by our elected leaders. Mr. Speaker, I commend this bill to this Honorable House and humbly invite all members to lend their support, and in doing so, to further strengthen the engagement and morale of civil servants who will now have the opportunity to work longer and provide for their families, all for the betterment of the people of the Cayman Islands. I thank you.
Does any other member wish to speak? Does any other member wish to speak? No other member wish to speak. Does the mover of the bill wish to exercise his right of reply?
Mr. Speaker, only to thank members for their support. Thank you.
The question is that a bill shortly entitled the Public Service Management Amendment Bill 2016 be given a second reading. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those against, no. Ayes have it. The Public Service Management Amendment Bill 2016 has been given a second reading.
The Public Service Pensions Amendment Bill 2016.
Call on the Honorable Deputy Governor.
Mr. Speaker, I beg to move the second reading of a bill entitled the Public Service Pensions Amendment Bill 2016.
The bill has been duly moved. Does the mover wish to speak thereto?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I rise to present the Public Service Pension Amendment Bill 2016. By way of background, the Public Service Pensions Law 2013 revision governs all aspects of the administration of pension benefits due to public servants enrolled in the Public Service Pensions Plan. Mr. Speaker, as a result of increases in life expectancy, not only in the Cayman Islands, but globally, it is only logical that the citizens of these Cayman Islands should be afforded the opportunity to have longer working lives. It is noteworthy that the retirement age in most other jurisdictions, including the UK, has been increased beyond the age of 60 for many years now. A national initiative to increase the normal retirement age is currently underway, and retirement age has already been increased to age 65 for private sector pension plans governed under the National Pensions Law. This initiative, Mr. Speaker, is consistent with Recommendation 49 of the EY report entitled Project Future, which recommended that government explore the impact of raising the retirement age for government workers to 65. Mr. Speaker, the portfolio of the Civil Service and the Public Service Pension Board have collaborated to educate the public service on the issues of extending the retirement age to 65, as well as to gauge the acceptability of such a proposal. During a six-week intensive information campaign, face-to-face meetings were held to solicit feedback from existing employees. These sessions targeted the civil service overall, but also focused on key audiences, including members of the Cayman Islands Civil Service Association, persons who were at or approaching the current retirement age, teachers ranging from Clifton Hunter High School to Northside to John Gray High School in Georgetown, managers and staff and general staff in the Sister Islands, hourly paid staff, HR professionals, heads of departments and chief officers. In total, more than 400 Mr. Speaker, 400 public servants participated in these voluntary workshops. In addition, the portfolio of the civil service has facilitated private advisors such as Mr. Ralph Lewis to come into the civil service and provide financial management advice to staff for how best to prepare for retirement at all stages of their working life. The response to this campaign was overwhelming, Mr. Speaker, in favor of the proposed increase. If there was a key concern that was expressed, it was, how soon can we make this happen? Mr. Speaker, I'm so pleased to stand in this Honorable House to recommend the passage of legislation that will allow our employees who are high performing to continue to work, to continue to save towards their retirement, to continue to be productive members of the Cayman society, to continue to serve in key roles, and to more consistently facilitate succession planning with the additional support they will be provided centrally over the coming years. Mr. Speaker, it is intended that the amendment would not only allow for public servants currently enrolled in the Public Service Pension Plan to be able to serve these Cayman Islands in gainful employment for a longer period of time, but will also allow them the opportunity to increase the value of their pension account, providing for greater financial stability in retirement. It is one of the issues that I'm sure all of us in this house here is, I want to retire, but I can't because my pension is too low. So this move, allowing people to continue to work, to continue to contribute to their pension, allows them to retire with a higher pension payout. Whereas this pension reform will have only a small impact on the financial status of the public service pension plan in the short term, as the majority of the current past service liability relates to persons who are already retired. The past service liability of the defined benefit part of the plan can decrease as more defined benefit participants exercise the option to work longer and deter retirement beyond age 60. The impact, while small, was estimated to be estimated to be as much as 30 million savings to the plan if all persons opted to work until age 65. Now we know, Mr. Speaker, that we will not get 100% universal take-up. That is, not all persons will choose to work until 65, but many will. We are seeing this already, even before the law has changed, Mr. Speaker. At the urging of honorable members of this parliament and our own employees, the number of persons who continue to work beyond age 60 is only continuing to grow within the civil service. As of June 2015, just over 5% of the civil service was age 60 or older. Of the persons who reached age 60 in 2014 and 2015, we had 90% and 81% respectively who opted to continue working. I ought to add, Mr. Speaker, that even with the amendments to our laws, our existing employees will retain the choice to retire at the current eligibility dates, which began as early as age 50. What they gain is the right to work longer if they so choose. As I shared, Mr. Speaker, even without being compelled, most persons choose to work longer. However, for persons employed after this law changes, the earliest that they may retire is at age 55. For persons who leave the civil service and then return, their date for being eligible to retire and claim their pension will be governed by the break in service rules. If they were out of the civil service for a period of 4 or more years, or for a period which was longer than were previously employed within the civil service, they will be treated like new employees and are only eligible for early retirement at age 55. As I stated, Mr. Speaker, most of our employees are choosing to stay with us when they approach age 60. However, while persons are currently working longer, our existing pensions laws does not allow them to accrue further savings at age 60 or the pension fund to achieve any benefits from them remaining active employees. This will change, Mr. Speaker, with amendments to the law. Mr. Speaker, for the first time, these changes will allow persons who are under the proposed retirement age, that is under 65, to re-enter a defined contribution pension plan, receiving a 12-month pension contribution, and to suspend receipt of their existing pension payment. This will allow persons who are under age 65 and still working to continue to accrue retirement savings. So, Mr. Speaker, there are persons right now in the civil service who are age 62. They have received their pension, they're continuing to work, but they cannot afford to retire because their monthly pension is not enough to keep them. What this will allow those persons to do is to come back to us and says, I would now like to re-enter the pensions plan. They will then, their salaries will then return to what they were before. they will then be allowed to continue to pay back into their pension plan, and then over the next few years, their pension will build up, and hopefully at age 65, they will be able to retire. So we have worked very hard to ensure that we're treating all our employees as fairly as possible, and we are driving the right behaviors. Because, Mr. Speaker, as you know, and I think all of us here knows, there are many misconceptions about public service pensions. There is a belief that all public servants have a huge nest egg and that they're in their public service pension. The reality is that pensions only became universal within the civil service in 2000, or 16 years ago. As such, for many persons, their savings remain quite modest. There is a feeling, Mr. Speaker, that all public servants are on the defined benefits pension. The reality is that less than 16% of the entire public service is on a defined benefit plan. 84% are on a defined contribution plan that only began 16 years ago. There is a feeling that persons who are on defined pension plans only have to work for a brief period, and then they get to live like kings and queens. Mr. Speaker, that too is false. Of the 876 active defined participants across the entire public service, approximately 30 or so of them are on plans that require them, 30, Mr. Speaker, I want to make that very clear, 30 are on plans that require them to work 33 and a third years in order to maximize their pensions. The vast majority, including myself, are on the defined benefit participant, have to work for the public service their entire careers, 40 years, in order to attain the maximum benefit. That is, the vast majority of the civil service have to work 40 years in order to attain their maximum pension benefit. As such, Mr. Speaker, the changes proposed benefits everyone. It benefits staff by allowing persons to save more money towards their ultimate retirement. It benefits civil servants by allowing greater retention of highly knowledgeable and experienced staff. It benefits the public service pension plan by requiring persons who are still working to cease drawing their pension, and thereby to reduce the demand on the fund and enhance the opportunities for the fund to be invested and to achieve investment returns. And it benefits the Cayman Islands by allowing citizens to work longer and to save longer so that they may live in dignity during their retirement and reduce the demands on younger generations to support them. With an aging population, this is of critical public importance. So, Mr. Speaker, I will just briefly go through the proposed amendments. Clause 1 provides for the short title of the bill. Clause 2 amends Section 3 of the Public Service Pensions Law to redefine the terms early retirement and to define salary grade in order to bring them in line with changes being made to the Public Service Management Law, which I just spoke to. Clause 3 repeals and replaces Section 23 of the Public Service Pensions Law 2013 to provide the guidelines and criteria for phased retirement, as well as to allow persons receiving a pension benefit to opt to rejoin the public service pension plan in the defined contribution part of the plan through reemployment or continued employment in the public service dependent on salary grade. A person under age 65 who obtains a contract renewal on the same or higher grade that they had prior to their retirement will be offered contracts that require them to resume contributions towards retirement and to cease drawing their pensions. Clause 4 amends Section 38 of the Public Service Pensions Law 2013 revision to allow persons in the defined benefit part of the plan to attain maximum pension eligibility up to age 65. Mr. Speaker, once this bill is passed, this amendment will be augmented through regulations to follow. So, Mr. Speaker, I humbly commend this bill to all members of this Honorable House and ask that they lend their support to this bill, and in doing so, increase the retirement age for persons employed in the public sector to age 65, affording public servants of these beloved Cayman Islands the opportunity to enjoy longer working lives and increase financial security in retirement, in keeping with this national initiative. I thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Does any other member wish to speak? I acknowledge the honorable member from North Side.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, at the risk of crossing that line in the sand and politicizing the civil service, I have but one question to ask. Why are we treating the civil service worse than the public pension plans by not using the same language that was so important for the pension, public pension plan that was used here at the last meeting to define retirement age? Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Does any other member wish to speak? Does any other member wish to speak? If no other member wishes to speak, does the mover of the bill wish to exercise his right of reply?
Mr. Speaker, thank you. The member from North Side did ask a question which I had alluded to in my opening remarks, in that we don't believe that the civil service is actually ready to move to that open door yet. So we are going to move things along in a structured way. But I thank all members for their support.
The question is that a bill shortly entitled the Public Service Pensions Amendment Bill 2016 be given a second reading. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those against, no. The ayes have it. The Public Service Pension Amendment Bill 2016 has been given a second reading. Madam Clerk.
The Nonprofit Organization Bill 2016.
Call on Honorable Minister of Financial Services.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I beg to move a motion under Standing Order 58, to withdraw this bill, to bring it back for a subsequent meeting and have it placed on our order paper, sir. And the reason for that, sir, is simply that we need additional time. We think we need additional time to ensure that we have proper public consultation and any necessary amendments which may flow from that. Thank you, sir.
The question is that this bill be withdrawn. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those against, no. The ayes have it. The bill is therefore withdrawn at this time. Madam Clerk.
The Confidentiality Information Disclosure Bill 2016.
Honorable Minister of Finance, am I correct? Financial Services.
Financial Services, sir. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I beg to move the second reading of a bill with the long title, A Bill for a Law to Repeal the Confidential Relationships Preservation Law 2015 Revision to provide for the circumstances under which confidential information may be disclosed and to provide for incidental and connected purposes.
The bill has been duly moved. Does the mover wish to speak there at all?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I am pleased to present this bill on behalf of the government, which seeks to provide a law to repeal and replace the Confidential Relationships Preservation Law, currently a 2015 revision. And Mr. Speaker, also to revise the circumstances in which a person may be required or authorized to disclose confidential information without the express consent of the person to whom the duty of confidentiality is owed. Further, to clarify the local competent authorities to whom information can be disclosed and in what circumstances. And finally, to remove the current criminal sanction for breach of disclosure of confidential information while maintaining the common law civil liability. Mr. Speaker, the Confidential Relationships Preservation Law has certainly served its purposes from the time of its original enactment. It was a good law with good intentions, but over time, Mr. Speaker, and particularly in recent years, it has become very clear that, in particular, the provisions dealing with the criminal sanction in respect of the unauthorized disclosure of confidential information has brought negative publicity, confusion, and really unwarranted criticism to the jurisdiction. Various international standard setters, Mr. Speaker, a number of the non-governmental organizations that speak on issues relevant to financial services, and in some cases, the media, both locally and internationally, often either misinterpret what the Confidential Relationships Preservation Law actually provides, or in some cases, they deliberately paint a distorted picture of this legislation as legislation which enables activities to be carried out for illicit purposes. Nothing is really, in fact, further from the truth, Mr. Speaker. But those are the types of issues that we have dealt with in relation to this particular piece of legislation. As an example, Mr. Speaker, we've had the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, commonly known as the OECD, issue a report which was entitled Tax Cooperation 2009 Towards a Level Playing Field. And that provides, with respect to the Confidential Relationships Preservation Law, that the Cayman Islands have what they refer to in the report as bank secrecy reinforced by statute. More recently, Mr. Speaker, as another example, we've had a report, a 2015 report from the Tax Justice Network, and the report was their Financial Secrecy Index, which specifically referred to the Confidential Relationships Preservation Law as a contributing factor in its rating of the Cayman Islands as the world's fifth most secretive jurisdiction. Mr. Speaker, if one was to do a comparison or a comparative analysis of the provisions of this jurisdiction that exist and the provisions which exist in law here, which deal with transparency, one could never, in the list which the Tax Justice Network was considering, the list of jurisdictions, one could never conclude that the Cayman Islands was the fifth most secret or secretive jurisdiction. not from an objective perspective, but simply because the confidential relationships preservation law exists and it has a provision which has a criminal sanction for the disclosure of confidential relationships, disclosure of confidential information, they reached the conclusion that this somehow elevates very substantially the Cayman Islands' secrecy rating. So, Mr. Speaker, that's very unfortunate, unjustified, but those are the types of background issues which explain why we are proceeding with and bringing this bill to repeal the existing law and to replace it with the new provisions in this new law, or new bill for a law to be called the Confidential Information Disclosure Law, 2016. Mr. Speaker, as stated earlier, the main provisions of the bill that distinguish it from the existing law are provisions that implement or enable the following. The bill seeks to firstly revise the circumstances in which a person may be required or authorized to disclose confidential information without the express consent of the person to whom the duty of confidentiality is owed. Secondly, it seeks to clarify the local competent authorities to whom information can be disclosed to and in what circumstances. And thirdly, Mr. Speaker, as I said earlier, to remove this current criminal sanction. But it importantly, Mr. Speaker, retains the common law civil liability. And just on that point, Mr. Speaker, there are a number of our competitor jurisdictions who actually rely only on the common law civil liability for breach of, or for this, the improper disclosure of confidential information. So we're not putting ourselves at a disadvantage, Mr. Speaker, in adopting this position. Mr. Speaker, it's anticipated that this bill will continue very effectively to protect confidential information that exists in the Cayman Islands or which is brought to the Cayman Islands. It is also believed that the passage of this bill will enhance the profile and record of transparency of the Cayman Islands by clarifying one of the core objectives of the Confidential Relationships Preservation Law, which is to provide local competent authorities gateways to access information. And that, Mr. Speaker, is a very vital point which is missed and misunderstood very often by international commentators, and on some occasions by local commentators. Mr. Speaker, the bill is arranged into six clauses. Clause 1 sets out the short title and commencement of the bill. Clause 2 makes provisions for the definition of certain words used in the bill. Clause 3 makes provisions for the circumstances where confidential information may be disclosed by a person who owes a duty of confidentiality without that person incurring civil liability. Clause 4 makes provision for the application to the court for directions in proceedings where confidential information is required to be given in evidence. Clause 5 makes provision for rules to be made by the Rules Committee of the Grand Court regarding the procedure to be followed where an application is made under this law. Clause 6, Mr. Speaker, repeals the Confidential Relationships Preservation Law 2015 revision. Mr. Speaker, many of the things that I've outlined here exist in the current law. Mr. Chairman, just for clarity of a point made by one of the members, as I said earlier, the existing Confidential Relationships Preservation Law has a provision for a criminal sanction for the breach of the unauthorized disclosure of confidential information. The member has asked why the law doesn't specify some other provision for a breach. What the law does, Mr. Speaker, is it provides that there is a common law duty for the breach of the unauthorized disclosure of confidential information, and that is this the civil liability which is being referred to in the law. So if there is a breach of confidential information, then through an unauthorized disclosure, and the person to whom the duty is owed suffers damages, they can certainly claim compensation from the person who was unlawfully disclose that information by pursuing an action under this common law provision. And that is the basis of the civil liability rule. All we are proposing to do with this bill, in large part, is to ensure that we take out this criminal liability sanction, because that is the thing, Mr. Speaker, which has attracted a tremendous amount of attention. It is not something that we feel is necessary for our purposes. It has never actually been utilized. No one has ever been charged with a criminal offense under this law in terms of disclosure of unlawful disclosure of information. So it's not something that's necessary for us and for the conduct of business in this jurisdiction, sir. We can continue to rely on the common law provisions and the civil liability sanction which exists as a result of that. And as I said earlier, sir, a number of our competitor jurisdictions actually simply rely on the common law rule. They don't have any piece of legislation which is specifically similar to our confidential relationships preservation law, or necessarily in the form of the bill that we are presenting here today. So, Mr. Speaker, with that, I hope this can effectively conclude my presentation on this bill. But I want to stress, Mr. Speaker, that very careful consideration has been given to this bill. It has been done entirely in consultation with the private sector. It is a matter which has been under discussion for a number of years, because it has been recognized, Mr. Speaker, that this particular law and the criminal sanction within it attracts unwarranted attention and unfair criticism. So we have the complete support of industry in respect of this, Mr. Speaker, and I certainly want to state and acknowledge the contributions of industry representatives in relation to this issue. And I want to thank in particular the members of the Financial Services Legislative Committee, certainly those members of staff in ministry. There are other private sector members who have contributed. And of course, the legal drafting department under the Honorable Attorney General, Mr. Speaker, because it is specialized legislation and it certainly has been the subject of lots of discussion, as I said. And I want to thank them all and recognize their contribution. Obviously, we all do it to ensure that we can enhance the essential and well-respected financial services industry of the Cayman Islands, and to ensure that that continues from strength to strength, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, with that, I commend this bill to this Honorable House for passage. Thank you very much.
Does any other member wish to speak? I acknowledge the Honorable Attorney General.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just to briefly say that in support of the bill, that I do share the observations by the Honorable Minister, especially in pointing out that it has been the confidential relationship preservation law has been unfairly characterized as secrecy legislation. Mr. Speaker, it is not a well-guarded secret that most countries around the world, most civilized democratic countries, do have in place provisions in their law that protect people's confidential information. It is a basic common law right, for example, that if you do business with a bank, the bank is under an obligation to keep your business confidential, keep it private. And I think this characterization of, I don't know if it's a characterization, but this deliberate attempt to conflate confidentiality with the sort of a pejorative use of the term secrecy has always been to malign, if you will, the reputation of these islands. And I say that, Mr. Speaker, because I am not aware, and I will challenge our international commentators to point that out to me, I'm not aware of one instance where there is a demonstration or a request, a legitimate request for information from the Cayman Islands, and that has been prevented by the use of any provision of the Confidential Relationship Preservation Law. Quite the contrary. The Confidential Relationship Preservation Law is a dedicated legislative gateway to provide information to those who have demonstrated a legitimate purpose for having those information, or getting that information, be it law enforcement agency or a regulatory agency. But I am not aware of anywhere else in the world, or any country in the world, where anyone, whether law enforcement or otherwise, can walk into a bank and ask about the balance in anybody's account and be provided with that information. So I am not so sure why the standard is being set or the bar is being set differently for the Cayman Islands. And I think it has been unfair over the years to characterize us as a secrecy jurisdiction, when in fact, if you look in a lot of countries, what they do, that they don't have a piece of legislation called the Confidential Relationship Preservation Law. But if you look in their banking law, you will see that there's a provision in there which speaks to confidentiality. And the Confidential Relationship Preservation Law was a codification, or is a codification, of the common law principle as we know it from way back in 1924, Mr. Speaker, a case named Turner and the Provisional Bank, where the issue of the relationship between a banker and a client and the obligation to treat the clients or the customers' information as confidential, that there was an issue, and that was settled from way back then. And all that happened in Cayman Islands is that that has been put into legislation. The important thing to also point out is that it is a common law right. It is a human right, rather, for persons' privacy to be respected. And the government is actively pursuing the enactment of data protection law as well, which will help to further underpin, or undergird, if you will, the privacy of persons as it relates to their personal information and so. I think the law has run its course. I agree with the Honorable Minister that to the extent that it is a lightning rod for us, if you will, focusing unnecessary attention on us in a kind of very bad way, it might not be a bad thing to dispense with it and sort of streamline the language to make it quite clear that whilst we protect and jealously guard people's confidentiality and the privacy, the fact of the matter is that even with the jettisoning of the criminal provision of the law, there is still recourse to the court if there is a breach of this confidentiality. And hopefully, persons will see this for what it is, which is, again, a clarification, if you will, of a long outstanding recognized right of every human being to have their privacy protected. I do thank you.
Does any other member wish to speak? Does any other member wish to speak? If no other member wishes to speak, does the mover of the bill wish to exercise his right of reply?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, let me thank the Honorable Attorney General for the contributions he has made in respect of this, the presentation of this bill. It certainly reflects the value and the content and the detail which he's provided. Certainly reflects the fact that he has been engaged on these issues. He typically represents the government on the Financial Action Task Force, or the Caribbean Financial Action Task Force discussions. And clearly, he is very capable and suitably equipped to do that in a most effective way. So I thank him very much for providing the additional clarity and detail around this. Mr. Speaker, I remember, probably kind of date myself now, but it was at least maybe 20 years ago. Let me not be unkind. Maybe let's say between 15 and 20 years ago. Might be a little bit more, I don't know. I remember a young lady at the time, Mrs. Dilbert, who I think at the time she was with the Cayman Islands Monetary Authority, and she was asked to do a presentation on the Confidential Relationships Preservation Law. And she started off saying, ladies and gentlemen, this law should be called the Disclosures Law, because that's the reality of what it is. It provides an effective gateway, an effective framework for the disclosure of confidential information in appropriate circumstances. And Mr. Speaker, that's where we're trying to get back to now. That's why we have proposed to set the name as a Confidential Information Disclosure Law, simply because we're trying to reflect very specifically what it is and address some of the issues and the and the malignment, which we have spoken about, both myself and the Attorney General have spoken about. Mr. Speaker, we have engaged with, for example, the Tax Justice Network. We have now engaged with them, and we're having discussions with them in terms of their next assessment of their secrecy index. And we will certainly ensure that they have a copy of the new law placed in front of them with the title highlighted and the fact that there is no criminal sanction any longer. So let's see how they respond in respect of that on that occasion, sir. But as I said, we will remain engaged and we will try to ensure and influence the perspective and move it from one of subjectivity and their own particular agenda to one of a clear, objective assessment. So, Mr. Speaker, with that, let me also thank all other members of this Honorable House for their support, and certainly my colleagues for their support in respect of this important bill, which will hopefully see us start to influence some change in perspectives on this particular issue as it relates to the Cayman Islands and our financial services, our very important financial services industry. I thank you very much, sir.
The question is that a bill shortly entitled the Confidential Information Disclosure Bill 2016 be given a second reading. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those against, no. The ayes have it. The Confidential Information Disclosure Bill 2016 has been given a second reading. The House will now go into committee to consider the bills, and I want to take a 5-minute break before we actually start the committee. I now call on the Minister of Education. I apologize in regards to the education bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise to move a motion under the relevant standing order to defer the second reading of the bill entitled the Education Bill 2016 until a subsequent meeting of this Legislative Assembly.
The question is that the education bill be deferred to a subsequent meeting of this House. Those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those against, no. The ayes have it. Thank you. We'll now take a 5-minute break.